Welcome back to historic Corlick Athletic Field. The Racine Raiders lost the coin flip. The Lima Warriors won, and they chose to defer to the second half. So the Raiders will get the opportunity to receive the ball first. Why don't we send it down to our sideline reporter, David Tukesbrey. David, how does the field conditions look out there today? It should be pretty ideal.
Right here at historic Corlick Athletic Field, the field is in pristine condition. Wind is blowing 8 or 9 miles an hour. Temperature is about in the mid, I'd say 70s right now. It's a perfect night for football, guys. And now the national anthem.
At the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bus bursting in air, they prove to the night that a flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the and the
National recording artist Cheryl McCrary with the national anthem here at historic Corlick Athletic Field. The Raiders will start on offense. We'll give you that starting offense. The front line, left to right, at left tackle, number 62, Chris Edwards, 6'6", 350 pounds out of the U.S. Army. At left guard, number 66, Wilton Jones, 6'2", 370 out of Whitnall High School. The center, number 79, Ronnie Lawless, 6', 300 pounds out of Franklin High School. At right guard, number 68, Dan Marshall, 6', 2 inches, 315 pounds out of the College of DuPage. And right tackle, number 77, Dusty Swenson, 6'3", 295 out of Union Grove High School. The tight end, number 85, Travis Worthington, 6'1", 225 out of Lakeland College. The receivers, number 3, Sam D'Elia, 5'9", 175 out of Corlick, and number 81, Dorian Palmer, 6'4", 190 out of Zion Benton High School. The backfield, number 31, Marcus Baskin, 5'11", 175 out of St. Catharines, and number 6, J.R. Taylor, 6'2", 260 out of Eastern Illinois University. And, of course, the quarterback, number 4, Craig McClelland, 6'5", 245 pounds out of the University of Wisconsin Oshkosh. Completed 56% of his passes for nearly 3,000 yards, 51 TDs, 13 interceptions, and had three more rushing TDs last season, averaging 6.5 yards per carry. For Lima, Nico Molina is out there to kick. Back deep for the Raiders, Demonche Pitt, along with Tori Ruffin. Line drive, kick, middle of the field is going to be picked up by Pitt at the 10-yard line. Pitt to the left side, the 20. Pitt the 30. Pitt the 35, and maybe stops just about a yard short of that at the 34-yard line. See where they officially mark it. The Raiders will have decent starting field position at the 35-yard line. A 25-yard return for Demonche Pitt to start this game out. Good to see Demonche Pitt back with the Raiders and back in returning kicks. It'll be exciting to watch him as this season progresses. The Raiders break the huddle with D'Elia breaking out wide to the right. Dorian Palmer to the left. Offset I formation backfield with Baskin offset to the right. Taylor the D-back. McClelland overlooking the defense. He's going to audible Worthington, the tight end on the right side of the formation. Snap looking to pass, throwing it up for Palmer. Palmer with a nice catch in Lima territory down to the 31-yard line. He outlefts Wayne LeGrand, who is on the coverage, and it's a pickup for the Raiders that's going to go for 33 yards on the first play from scrimmage. McClelland hooking up with Palmer like they didn't miss the offseason at all. Same formation. Yancey Donald, the linebacker on the left side, tapping his helmet. The snap, the ball is loose, and McClelland dives on it. It's going to be a loss of a yard back to the 32-yard line, bring up second down and 11 for the Raiders. Just a minute into this one as the Raiders begin their 2013 season. Trying to match what they did in 2012 with a semi-pro BCS national championship. Baskin comes out, offset to the left. Eight men in the box. As the handoff goes to J.R. Taylor, he stutter steps, and he's going to be brought down after a gain of just one on the tackle, Barry Peel for Lima. And it'll bring up third down and nine. They give him credit for two on that. Third down and nine for the Raiders. Ball at the 31-yard line of Lima. Worthington, tight end on the left side of the formation. Receiver to each side. Baskin offset to the left. Once again, eight men in the box, all crowded at the line for Lima. Showing blitz. They don't come. The pitch to Taylor to the left. Taylor is going to be upended just inside the 30-yard line. Gets to the 26. A pickup of five will bring up a fourth down and four for Racine. Decision time for the Raiders at the 26-yard line. It looks like Racine's going to go for it. Dalia to the right. Palmer to the left. I formation backfield. Baskin slightly offset to the right. Fourth down and five for the Raiders. McClellan looking to pass. Pump fakes the right. Throws to the left to Palmer. He makes the catch. Down inside the five-yard line to the three. A gain of 28 on the play. And a Raiders first down. What a conversion on fourth and five. And the Raiders are inside the five-yard line of Lima, and they are picking on Wayne LeGrant, trying to cover Dorian Palmer out on the left side. LeGrant giving up several inches at 5 feet, 9 inches. Offset eye to the right. McClellan gives it to Taylor. Taylor, a stutter step, tries to go right up the middle. The interior of the line takes him down.
To play in the first quarter, opening drive of the game for Racine. They took the opening kickoff. Dalia to the right, Palmer to the left. Offset I formation backfield, tight end on the right side. McClelland rolling out to his right, throws it to Dalia. Touchdown, Raiders! The Raiders take a 6-0 lead on Lima as they march down the field 65 yards, and they get the opening score of the game.
That's the way to start the season, get a touchdown on the opening drive, and put points on the board.
Coming on for the extra point attempt is Joel Dupras. The drive taking 3 minutes and 57 seconds, going 65 yards. Snap is good, hold is down, the kick is up, and it is good, and the Raiders lead 7-0 with 11:03 to play in the first quarter. We'll take a timeout. You're listening to Racine Raiders Football on News Talk 1400, WRJN. So the Raiders score on their opening drive of the 2013 season. Craig McClelland to Sam Dalia, a 4-yard touchdown pass. McClelland 3 for 3 for 61 yards. Dupras, a lot of leg into that one, going with the wind and being driven deep into his end zone is Billy Kozad. He's going to have to take a knee, and it's going to be first and 10 for Lima at their own 20-yard line. And Joel used that 9-10-mile-an-hour wind and really gave that ball a ride.
Oh, Tom, it gave a ride. The receiver in the end zone only had about a foot to stay in play, and he could have let it go and taken it out to the 20. But it was smart. He was 10 yards deep before he could even bring it out.
So that Raiders defense out there now, Lima will have to reset them here. The lineup that we got is not accurate, but Kane Runyon is their quarterback. He's going to be in the shotgun. To his right, Jeremy Bott. One receiver to the left, three receivers to the right. Takes a snap, looking to pass right side, and his first pass is complete to Billy Kozad across the 25-yard line. The ball was tipped at the line of scrimmage. Kozad still comes down with it, and it's going to be a gain of 8 on first down all the way up to the 28-yard line. It'll be second down and 2 for Lima.
Justin Binkle staying home on that play and picking up the read and making the tackle along with a little help from number 50, Brandon Hendrickson.
Lima breaks out. To the left is Bobby Huddis. Two receivers to the right. I formation backfield. Fullback is Zach Jackson. In motion, right to left, Billy Kozad. Handoff goes to Jeremy Bott. Bott tries the left side. He's going to get enough for a first down across the 30, up to the 33-yard line. A gain of 5 on the play. Justin Ankley on the tackle, and it'll be a first and 10 for Lima.
Yeah, Lima went right up the middle of that defense, defensive line, and didn't get much on that play. Coach Pivovar was worried about the defense a little bit. I don't think he's got anything to worry about right now.
Bobby Huddis, Jeremy Bott out to the left, empty backfield, three receivers to the right for Kane Runyon in the shotgun. First and 10, takes the snap, looking over the field, under pressure, throws it out, Raider sideline, caught by David Johnson and immediately pushed out of bounds by Justin Benko up at the 37-yard line, a gain of 4 on the play. It'll bring up a second down and 6 for Lima with 9:20 to play in the first quarter. They trail 7-0.
Runyon was almost looking like he was setting up for a screen pass on that play, but the rush came kind of hard, and he had to unload that ball or else he was going to be taking a sack. Good job by the defensive line.
Raiders scored on the opening drive. 7 plays, 65 yards, got a touchdown. Empty backfield again, two receivers left, three receivers to the right. Runyon in the shotgun. Quick pass in the flat to Bott. Bott with some room along the Warrior sideline and pushes his way near the 50-yard line. Looks like he stepped out of bounds just short at about the 48, but a gain of 14 on the play. It'll bring up another first down for Lima as Lima is moving the ball in this five-receiver set, Tom.
That play was exactly the play that Runyon wanted to run the previous before, but had the heat coming on by the defensive line of the Raiders. They kind of backed off on that time. That last play backed off, and they let him throw the ball.
Huddis all alone to the left, two receivers to the right. Runyon with a back to each side. He's in the shotgun. First and 10, takes it, hands it off to the fullback Jackson, and Jackson is stood up by the Raiders, keeps his legs moving, and gets up to midfield. Picks up a couple of yards on it. It'll bring up a second down and 8. Initial contact by Brandon Hendrickson and Nate Harris.
Nate Harris gave him a real nice hug, said welcome to Racine, kind of stopped him, but they still got some yardage on that play, 2 yards. Would have been nice if they could have stuffed him at the line of scrimmage. A little bit more presentation by the defensive line would help.
Bott checks out. Yancey Donald checks in for Lima. Out to the left is Huddis. Right is Johnson. And Kozad in the slot. Two backs in the backfield. Runyon in the shotgun. Takes the snap, looking to pass under pressure. Middle of the field, throws it high and incomplete. Leaping up for it is Torrey Ruffin, but it was thrown well over anyone's head. The intended receiver, Billy Kozad, and it'll bring up a third down and 8 for Lima.
Billy Kozad's listed as 5'9" for him. In order for him to catch that ball, he had to be at least 6'5". That ball was thrown well over his head.
It was a perfect pass if he had Dorian Palmer cutting across the middle.
Oh, really? Or a stepladder.
Kozad, slot left. Huddis, wide left. Two receivers to the right. Three receivers now over to the left side. Nobody in the backfield for Runyon. Runyon takes the snap, quick pass, and it's caught by Kozad. He was fighting the Raider defender Jordan Scott for it, but it looks like he's going to be short of a first down with the catch at the 43-yard line. It's going to bring up a fourth down and 1 maybe two for Lima, and it's decision time for them as they're in no man's land. It looks like Joe Petrenis is going to call for a measurement. Of course, the markers on the Raiders sideline, so they're going to have to bring them all the way across to the far end of the field towards the Warriors sideline.
Jordan Scott read that play quite well. He saw that play coming. He timed it just right. Just a fraction of a second off to get his arm in there, and maybe he had a pickoff on that, but holding him to that play was all right, too.
The Raiders starters on defense as they go for this measurement. Michael Ambrose, number 72, getting a start. 6'2", 235 out of Gateway at left end. Left tackle, number 95, Jaron the Bullet Rutledge, as they're a full yard short. 6'2", 290 out of Knox College. The right tackle, number 97, Justin Ankley. 6'3", 332 out of UW-Whitewater. And the right end, number 90, Ardre Jarrett. 6'4", 320 out of Waukegan High School. The backers across the middle, left to right, number 54, Jordan Scott. 6', 252 pounds out of Bradford High School. Number 50, Brandon Hendrickson. 6', 220 out of Bradford as well. And number 52, Nate Harris. 6', 235 out of Carroll University. The corner, number 7, Nate Hurd, 5'11", 196 out of Oshkosh. And number 5, Tracy Baskin, 6', 240 out of St. Catharines. Lining up to go for it on 4th and a yard is Lima. I formation backfield behind Runyon.
Straight I formation. You can kind of guess what's going to happen up the middle.
Zach Jackson, the fullback. The handoff goes to Jackson. The Raiders got penetration, but Jackson bounces off it.
The reach doesn't count.
And they have to see the spot, and it looks like he might be just short. They're going to have to do another measurement here.
Yeah, Jackson on that play tried to get it with the reach, and the reach doesn't count. It's where the elbow comes down on the ground, and he's going to be short.
The safeties, number 2, Justin Benko, 6', 196 out of North Park University, and number 30, Tori Ruffin, 6'2", 200 out of Concordia University. They're going to bring the chains. Craig McClellan and Sam DeLee are out there in their with their helmets on, and they're going to stretch this, and I think you're right, Tom. No chance on this one. They are short.
Great defensive stand by the Raiders, holding them. They read that play. They saw the stack formation. They knew what was coming up the middle, pinched in, forced the guards and tackle, or the guards on either side of the center to crunch into. No place for that play to go.
So Lima turns it over on downs, already trailing 7-0 with 7:06 to play in the first quarter. The Raiders offense on the field with good starting field position again at their own 42-yard line. Sam DeLea breaks out to the right and slot right for the first time this season. Dom Kegel out there. Palmer out to the left. DeLea in motion, right side to slot left. Handoff goes to Taylor in the backfield. He's tripped up, does a good job of staying on his feet to pick up some positive yardage. And with the ankle tackle is Barry Peel. It's going to be a gain of 2 on the play. Bring up 2nd down and 8 for Racine.
It was interesting talking to JR, and I got it right this time on the coach's show this morning. You know, talking about his injury last year, that guy played hurting, and he didn't let anybody know. It was surprising to hear it, and he's the type of athlete that will play like that.
Raiders coach is huge on number 8, Dom Kegel. Say he's maybe the best athlete on the team, can play anywhere. The handoff goes to Taylor. Taylor, left side, breaks a tackle across midfield. The whole team converging on J.R. Taylor, and they finally bring him down at the 46-yard line. It's a gain of 10 and a first down for the Raiders.
And the other thing J.R. talked about this morning was his experience that he's had playing in the indoor football. And that was quite evident on that play, because you don't get to that level by giving up. He played, he hung on to that ball, he didn't let him strip it, and he got a first down.
DeLea and Kegel out to the left, Palmer out to the right, offset I formation backfield, Baskin and Taylor. DeLea in motion, wide left to slot right. McClellan looking to pass under immediate pressure, throws it up near the sideline as he's falling backwards, and they're looking whether they should be throwing an intentional grounding. Nobody got there, but it made the line of scrimmage, but Joe Petrenis pulls out the flag.
Yeah, Craig didn't go to either side. He kind of went straight back. He was inside the pocket when he threw that ball, and it was just a matter of time of determining, you know, where he came down, where the ball was set, and boom.
On the pressure was Barry Peel. He's the first one through for Lima.
That almost looked like a setup screen play, and all of a sudden his receivers didn't take off. Could have been some miscommunication on what that was supposed to be.
So going to push the Raiders all the way back to the 34-yard line. A huge loss for Racine of 20 yards and a loss of down. It'll bring up second down and 30 with 5.5 minutes to play here in the first quarter. Racine leads 7-0. Kegel wide right, D'Elia slot right. Palmer to the left. Offset I formation backfield. Baskin offset to the right. Now the officials are going to talk about the spot of the ball.
Second down.
And to confirm that it is second down, loss of down on the intentional grounding. So ball at the 34-yard line. Second down and 30 for the Raiders. McClellan looking to pass, backside pressure, and he throws it in the direction of J.R. Taylor, incomplete. On the pressure again was Barry Peel, and it's going to bring up a third and a country mile for the Raiders.
Peel just came around the side. Nobody near him. Nobody touched him. But he's got to be picked up on that play, on those plays.
5:14 to play in the first quarter. 7-0, the Raiders lead. They went down the field 65 yards on six plays on their opening drive. Craig McClellan hit Sam D'Elia on a 4-yard touchdown pass to give the Raiders the lead. Kegel and D'Elia to the right, Palmer to the left. McClellan got to the line quickly, acted like he was going to snap it quick, and then backed off. A lot of confusion among the Warriors. Takes the snap. Might have been an offsides. A handoff to Taylor, and Taylor is going to be dropped across the 35 up at the 37-yard line. A gain of 3, but a flag on the play, and I think the Raiders had a free one there.
Yeah, they're going to take the 5 yards and replay third down. The blitzing linebacker came in just a little bit too quick, was in the neutral zone before the snap, and it's going to cost them 5.
So bring up 3rd and 25 for the Raiders with 5 minutes to play in the first quarter. They lead 7-0.
Beautiful night for football.
Oh, just an absolute perfect night. Nice breeze out here.
And a bunch of hungry Raider fans wanted football, and they're showing up tonight.
Great crowd. The bleachers on our side are pretty well packed, Tom. Two receivers right, one to the left. McClellan under center, drops back, has some time, looking to pass, looking Palmer, left side. Palmer leaps, but it's thrown way over his head down at the 25-yard line, out of bounds, and it's going to bring up 4th and 25, and Joel DePra is going to come on to punt. DePra will have a pretty stiff breeze at his back.
Yeah, some of the officials in the crowd on that play wanted a pass interference, but that ball was definitely over Dorian's head, uncatchable. No harm, no foul on that.
So that Raiders drive goes nowhere, even a little backwards, as they ended at the 39-yard line. DePra, snap is right at his face mask, gets off a wobbly kick. Kozad fields it at the 20-yard line. Kozad going backwards is Ruffin rips him down, and a flag comes out. And it looks like they might get Ruffin for a face mask, and it's going to give the Warriors some extra yardage.
Yeah, Torrey was on there, got a little aggressive. May not have been a face mask, but got him around the collar or inside the helmet, which is the same thing as a face mask. Horty might pick it up.
Oh, he called it. So 15-yard face mask added to the end of the run from the 20. They're going to put it at the 35-yard line, it looks like.
The Lima Warriors came to play They're not doing a bad job, but on the other side of the coin, the Raiders are shooting themselves in the foot a little bit right now with the mistakes. You expect from the first game for that to happen.
They break out with an empty backfield, two receivers to the left, three receivers to the right. Runyon, the quarterback in the shotgun formation. In motion, Kozad, fakes the handoff to Kozad, passes it, Nate Harris knocks it down at the 40. He gets a paw on it, and it's going to bring up second down and 10 for Racine.
Again, staying home, Nate Harris read that play. Wish he could have got two paws on that. Would have been a pick six probably, but knocking it down is just as good.
Nate had the interception that sealed the national championship victory last season. Checking out of the game for Lima is Mike Macklin. Second down and 10 for Lima. Out to the left, Jay Johnson. Kozad and David Johnson to the right. Backs on each side of Runyon. He's looking to pass, and he's able to hit Jeremy Bott, being covered by Harris at the 40. Bott gets yardage up to the 42-yard line, maybe even 43. A gain of 8 will bring up third down and 2 for Lima.
Lima's seen something in the Raider defense that they're taking advantage of. It may be the splits in the gaps or something, or how the defensive men, linemen are attacking, but they're taking advantage of it. The Raiders got to get on the bench. When they get on the bench next time, they got to figure it out.
I formation backfield behind Runyon. Raider faithful getting into it. The handoff goes to Pott, and Bott taken down right away. Justin Benko and Ardre Jarrett get in there and cut him down at the knees at the 40. A loss of 3. It'll bring up a 4th and 5 for Lima.
That Jarrett was in that backfield so fast to bring down that ball carrier, it almost like he was in the huddle with the Warriors on that play.
Mike Macklin on to punt, standing inside his 30-yard line. Demonche Pitt and Torrey Ruffin standing back at the 30 and 25-yard line. Now they're taking a couple more steps back. Macklin punting into this stiff breeze. Takes this little snap, gets off a punt towards Ruffin, far sideline. He fields it right at the 30, hit, but stays on his feet and then taken down from behind as he crosses the 35 to the 36-yard line. On the tackle, Billy Kozad, he made initial contact, and Ruffin just bounced off him, but then Kozad caught him from behind.
Well, you needed help on that second effort. Two guys brought Ruffin down, but anybody else taking a hit like that, they would have been laid out across the sideline out of bounds. Ruffin kept his feet, kept his head up, and he kept going. Outstanding footwork by Torrey.
So first and 10 for the Raiders, 2:45 to play in the first quarter. They lead 7-0. Palmer to the right, D'Elia to the left, and now we have a whistle. Looks like Lima may have called a timeout. They did.
Timeout Warriors.
So the Warriors take their first timeout of the half. They have two remaining. The Raiders leading 7-0 here at Historic Horlick Athletic Field as they begin defense of their 2012 Semi-Pro BCS National Championship. And for Lima, this is the Raiders are the third team that they will play this season that have laid claim to a 2012 national championship. They lost, two of their three losses are to teams with a 2012 national championship in the Detroit Ravens and the Columbus Fire.
Well, you can't, you know, take anything away from Lima because you look at it, they had a long trip today. Their bench is not a short bench, but it's not the biggest one they probably have at home. But they're here to play football, and the Raiders got their job cut out for them. And like we talked with Coach Perfetto 2 weeks ago on the coaches show, when you're on top, there's only one direction you can go.
Demetrius Thompson in the backfield along with Floyd Underwood in the offset eye, offset to the left. D'Elia goes in motion left side. The pitch goes to Underwood. Underwood breaks a tackle, gets outside. Underwood loses his footing but gets up to the 50-yard line. It's going to be a gain of 13 and a first down for the Raiders as they move the chains.
Nice block by number 24, Demetrius Thompson, on that play. Set up the ability for for the play to run to the outside, to the near sideline. Got tied up in that block, stuck with it, gave it some running room.
John Sturba, the tight end on the right side of the formation. I formation backfield offset to the right. Receiver to each side for McClelland under center. Takes a snap, pitch to Underwood to the right, and Underwood's met in the backfield and taken down on the tackle for Lima. Jason Bott, it's going to be a loss of yardage back to the 42-yard line. A loss of 43, check that, a loss of 7 will bring up second down and 17. Under 2 minutes to play in the first quarter, Raiders lead 7-0.
Jason Bott in the linebacking side of the field on that play, read it, came in unabated, and met Floyd for that loss. You got to give him credit for reading that play and making a good tackle.
Raiders break the huddle in the same formation, second down and 17. McClelland looking over the defense. Yancey Donald hitting his helmet on the right side. Looking to pass McClelland. He has time. Looking for D'Elia down the far sideline and knocked away at the last second by Brant Huddis inside the 25-yard line. It falls incomplete. It'll bring up a third and 17 for the Raiders.
You got the Raider offensive line did a good job giving Craig a two-banana count with the blocking. You like to see him get the three bananas to get rid of that ball. On that play, I think Craig was shaded a little bit to who he could see as a potential receiver, and that pass may have been hurried a little bit.
Are you hungry again, talking about food?
You got it.
That seems a little healthy for you, though. Palmer and Kegel out to the right. Kegel slot right. Tight end Sturba on the left side of the formation. I formation backfield. McClelland looking to pass and hits Kegel along the Warriors sideline. Kegel with a first down as he gets inside the Warriors 40 to the Warrior 38-yard line. That's going to be a gain of 19. Actually, they mark it all the way down to the 16, a gain of 21, or the 36, a gain of 21, and a Raiders first down.
Talking with Coach Nelson a couple of weeks ago, we were talking about Kegel and how he was brought into the Raiders as a potential quarterback. But when Craig came back, he was a real athlete about it. He says, I can play receiver too. And I think this is going to be a combination that a lot of teams are going to have to put up with.
Receiver to each side. Handoff goes to Underwood. He fights his way, trying to fight his way through the heart of that line. And maybe gets half a yard. We'll call it no gain. Second down and 10, as that'll likely be the final play of the first quarter, and it is, as Craig McClelland starts coming over towards the sideline. So after one quarter of play, the Raiders lead the Lima Warriors 7-0. We'll be back after this commercial break. You're listening to Racine Raiders Football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN!
Tom, quite a game for the two quarterbacks already in that first quarter. They combined to go 9 for 15 for 120 yards. Craig McClelland, 4 of 8 for 82 yards in the TD. Runyon, 5 for 7 for 38 yards. J.R. Taylor, 5 carries for 16 yards, really the only rusher of note in that first half. Dorian Palmer with the big catch, the 34-yard pass from McClelland, and he has 2 catches for 57 yards. And Sam D'Elia had the 1 touchdown catch that was went for 4 yards.
You look at the passing, the attempts and completions by the quarterbacks, it's obvious McClelland is seeing receivers further down the field, and you're talking 82 to 38 yards total. So that's what's happening in that department. So far, from what I'm seeing up here, the offensive line has to kind of pull them up a little bit and tighten it up. They're not giving McClelland enough time, or if they give him enough time, they're not giving him a good view. They got to keep that Lima defense out of the backfield so McClelland can get those passes off.
Raiders with 6 first downs to the Warriors, 2, 22 rushing yards to 5, 104 total yards. Check that, 103 as it just updated to 43 for Lima. 6.1 yards per play for the Raiders, 3.9 for Lima. Time of possession, 6:46 for Racine, 5:29 for Lima. Raiders will start the second quarter with a second down and 10, ball at the 36-yard line of the Warriors. Kegel slot right, Palmer out wide right, near sidelines. I formation backfield behind McClellan. Drops back, looking to pass. Immediate pressure going to be brought down from behind. Barry Peel again on the sack, and he's been getting a lot of pressure. He got some assistance at the end by Gino Burden. A loss all the way back to the 45-yard line. It'll bring up a third down and 19 for the Raiders.
And these guys are coming in from the backfield. They're coming in from the, like I said, the defense, the linebacking slots, the safety slots, and the offensive linemen just aren't picking them up. And you know, you go back to old school, football 101. If you can't remember who you're supposed to block on a play, you knock down the first opposite color jersey.
Sam D'Elia checks in for Kegel. He's slot right. Palmer out wide right. I formation backfield. Thompson and Underwood behind McClellan, who drops back, has time, looking to pass. Now under pressure, rolls out to his left, buys some time, has all day, still looking, comes back across the field to his right, looking for some help. Now throws it all the way across the field to Dorian Palmer. Palmer with the catch at the 26, but a flag comes out. Palmer brought down at the 18-yard line, and this one might be coming back for lineman downfield.
Lineman downfield or a holding?
And it looks like holding is the initial indication.
When you get that much time to throw the ball, it's usually somebody assisted their block with something illegal.
Watch that play, not just bullshit. Ineligible downfield, number 67 on the offense. Be a 5-yard penalty from the spot, from the previous spot. Replay third down.
So it's going to bring up a third and 24 for the Raiders. Ball will be right at midfield. Nose on the stripe of the 50-yard line.
that was a shame it ended up, because he wasn't downfield by much. It was maybe like a foot or two. And it was like, oh no, that type of play.
Negates a big gain of about 36 yards for Racine and a first down. Now they come out third and 24. Two receivers to the right. I formation backfield behind McClellan. A quick pass to D'Elia, and he bounces it to him. It'll bring up a fourth down, and Joel Dupras likely to come on to punt.
The Raiders offense, it's not an easy game for them right now. It's a good thing they were able to put those quick 7 points on the board, because the defense has been doing an outstanding job shutting down Lima. The offense, they need a little bit of work, but again, it's the first game of the season. Hopefully in the second, in the halftime, they'll go and talk about it and get it repaired.
Josh Willis, the new long snapper this season for the Raiders, gets a nice quick snap to Dupras. Dupras boots it into that pretty stiff breeze. It hits at the 15-yard line, takes a Lima bounce out to the 22, and Lima will have the ball first and 10 at their own 22-yard line with 13:30 to play. A net of 28 yards on that punt for Joel Dupras.
And it was nice to see Joel come back to camp this year, see him practice. You know, the core players that were here last year are back. They wanted to come back, and, you know, obviously Joel was one of them. You know, it would have been a different team without Joel.
Joel just did a phenomenal job kicking and punting last season. Was very reliable. As Lima lines up two receivers to the right, one receiver to the left, tight end off the right side of the formation. Bott, the lone back in the backfield, he's to the right of Runyon. Runyon in the shotgun, takes a snap, looking to his right, throws it out, and throws it short of his intended receiver, David Johnson, out at the 40-yard line, right at the numbers, and he'll bring up a second down and 10 for Lima.
Jordan Scott, number 54, coming from the, it looked like the left end position, coming untouched, putting heat on Runyon and making him unload that ball.
No huddle for Lima. Same formation. Runyon in the shotgun. Takes a snap, hands it off to Bott. Bott tries the middle, and it looks like Jaron Rutledge rides him down to the ground. He gets to the 22, maybe 23-yard line. A gain of 2 on the play will bring up a third down and 8 for Lima. Check that, a third and 9 as they give him credit to the 22.
And again, good read by the defense. The defensive line shutting it down, sealing off the line, sealing off the gaps, and holding that play to that Monty yardage.
Once again, two receivers left, one to the right. Tight end on the right side of the formation. Runyon in the shotgun with Bott to his right. He checks his wristband. Ready to go. Takes a snap. Looking. Has some time. Now under pressure. Rolls out to his right. Trying to run away from Rutledge, and he can't do it. Jaron Rutledge pulls him down from behind, and like his nickname, he looked like a bullet chasing after Runyon. Brings him down at the 21-yard line, but there's a flag on the near side of the field.
Yeah, and he also changed Runyon's jersey from a medium to an extra large. He really stretched it out.
They wave off the flag, so give Jaron Rutledge a sack on the play, a loss of one. Brings up fourth and 10, and Lima's going to be forced to punt with 12:34 to play in the first half.
So far, the Raider defense has been keeping that lead on the board for them. They're doing just an outstanding job. The backs are reading, the linebackers are reading the play excellently. The linemen are getting penetration. Just a great job.
Raiders have to take a timeout as they thought they had too many people on the field, and I don't think they did. Oh, they did have too many. They had 12 out there. Benko ran off at the last minute, so Raiders take their first time out of the half. Want to let our fans know that the Raiders on Monday, if you go to the Texas Roadhouse on Green Bay and 11 in Racine to have dinner, the proceeds from the food sales that night will go to the Raiders organization. So if you have no plans on Monday night, make sure that you head out to Texas Roadhouse in Racine. Have yourself a nice dinner, a couple of drinks perhaps, and the proceeds from that will go to the Raiders organization.
That's worth a triple hamburger, you know.
You don't need any more heart attack burgers.
Smothered in onions.
There you go. A slab of meat.
You got it.
Baked potato.
Ribs.
Are we making you hungry yet, folks?
And peanuts. They got plenty of peanuts out there.
Macklin standing inside his 10-yard line. Demonche Pitt standing back inside the Raider 35. Punt is off, nearly blocked by Ankley. Pitt lets it drop and gets out of the way of it at the 30. It's going to be downed by Kozad at the 29-yard line. And that punt is going to go for 50 yards.
You know, the wind doesn't look like it's blowing that hard, but it's got to be affecting the ball. It looks like it's maybe about a 5 to 10 mile an hour breeze, but you know, being in a bowl situation like the field is, you get it up, and it's going to take off on you. Good job by Demonte Pitt, though, by recognizing he's not going to touch that ball. Last year, he had a couple of punts that he thought otherwise, and he got burnt on them, but. He's matured in that way.
Dave, maybe between plays here after this one, you can let us know how the wind conditions seem on the field. I know you're at ground level down there, but it's hard to tell up in this press box what the wind is doing other than but going by the flag, how the flags are blowing. A lot of confusion between Kegel and D'Elia. Now Kegel goes from slot left to slot right, and D'Elia is still saying something to him. D'Elia all alone to the left side. Now moving Kegel back is McClelland. Fakes the handoff. Rolls out to his right. Looking to pass. Hits Kegel coming out of the backfield. Kegel, the 30, the 35, and pushed out of bounds at the 36-yard line. A gain of 6 on the play. It wasn't pretty, but it'll be second down and 4 for Racine.
That's a combination that you look at. You got two guys that can throw the football, Kegel and McClelland. And I wouldn't be surprised if later on down the road we see something happen with a pretty maneuverable play on that. But Kegel, he's a guy you're not going to, with his playing experience, you're not going to knock him down with your shoulder pads. You got to tackle him. You hit him with your shoulder pads, he's just going to bounce right off and keep going.
12-13 to play here in the first half, 7-0. For the Raiders. After this play, we'll send it down to Dave on the sideline. Two receivers to the left, one to the right. Underwood to the left of McClelland. Now going into the backfield is Kegel. Fakes a handoff to Underwood, rolling out to his right. McClelland's going to be brought down in the backfield, back at the 28-yard line. And on the sack, celebrating right in McClelland's face, trying to get a number. if you get a number, Tom, feel free. Dave, why don't you tell us what you got on the sideline?
Yeah, Don, you were talking about the wind a little bit. It's picking up right now, but a little bit more importantly, Tracy Baskin taking a seat on the bench on that last defensive possession. Lyrel Johnson seeing his first action of the season at DB. We'll keep an eye on Baskin and his health.
Thank you very much. Baskin just named a captain this season. Brings up a 3rd and 12 for the Raiders back at the 28-yard line. Two receivers left. Kegel all alone to the right. He goes in motion into the backfield, fakes the handoff, and McClellan rolling out to his left on the option. He's just going to keep it himself and rolls up on to Dorian Palmer. Gets across the 30 up to the 32-yard line. It'll bring up a 4th down and 8 for Racine. They're going to be forced to punt.
Yeah, McClellan took a pretty good hit on that play. It's one of those jarring type of hits from behind. It looks like what's happening with the Raider offensive line that they're doing some double teaming on the weak side of the play, leaving that gap between the center and the guard wide open.
DePras standing inside his 20-yard line. Willis the long snapper, low. DePras picks it off the ground, gets off a high but shorter punt. Going to land at the 47 and take a Lima bounce out of bounds at the Raider 48-yard line. Lima with their best starting field position of the game as that punt goes for just a net of 16 as DePras was kicking into that breeze.
Yeah, it is funny because not a wind has kicked up. The flags are a little bit more out and we can feel it in the press box, which makes it feel good for us. But, yeah, that wind is becoming a factor in the punting and probably the passing game too.
10:34 to play here in the first half. Raiders with a 7-0 lead. Opening drive, 4-yard touchdown pass from McClellan to D'Elia. Two receivers to the left, David Johnson and Jay Johnson. One receiver to the right. Runyon in the shotgun with a back to his right. Looks to be bought. Fans pounding on the aluminum bleachers. Runyon throwing to his right and overthrowing and behind his intended receiver. Looks to be Nico Molina on the coverage out there. A new addition to the Raiders, Nate Hurd. Everybody's excited to see what Nate Hurd can do this season. They were really hoping to have Hurd and David Earl as two shutdown corners this year, but they had to really replace Earl with Hurd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, on that play, it looked like Molina just stopped on the route. He was being led a little bit. He just stopped and the ball went right by him.
Two receivers set to each side. Runyon takes the snap out of the shotgun, throws it out to David Johnson at the 45-yard line between the numbers, and Johnson tries to make a diving catch, but it falls incomplete. It'll bring up 3rd down and 10 for Lima.
That was a gutsy throw by Runyon because he had the whole Raider defensive line coming in. The line was pushing back that offensive line, and the ball did not go over the top of the heads. It went between bodies.
Trips right, two receivers left, empty backfield. Runyon claps his hands. Torrey Ruffin audibles to the defense. Takes a snap, looking. Quick pass to his right to Macklin. Macklin at the 45, brought down by Justin Benko, but not before he gets inside the 40, near a first down to the 39-yard line. Looks to be about a yard short on the pickup of 9. It'll bring up a 4th and 1. And I would imagine Lima is going to go for it in this situation with no real kicker that made the trip today.
Good cutback on that play by the receiver. He could have kept on going and probably got stuffed, but making that cutback like he did with the movement that he did gained him that extra yard or two that he needed.
And Lima takes their 2nd time out of the half as they want to talk this one over. A 4th and 1, ball on the Raider 39-yard line. 9:56 left to play here in the first half. The Raiders lead 7-0. Stay tuned at halftime. Had an opportunity to talk to longtime Racine Raiders and King County Eagles player Dan Morgel. Dan played with King County for a number of years, then came up here to play with Racine. He's played with a couple of other teams, has had a decent career in indoor football, was on the practice squad of the Chicago Bears for a while, which I didn't know till talking to him today. So very, very interesting discussion with offensive lineman Dan Morgel.
You know, you got to be something special to be willing to work the practice squad, because you're everybody else. you're going to get nailed. You have to learn everybody else's playbook, and if the offense or defense, depending what side that you're playing on, doesn't get it right, they have to do it again, and you're going to get killed again. So you got to give them a lot of credit on that practice squad.
So on fourth and one, it's Runyon all alone in the backfield. Now he comes under center. Quick snap right up the middle, a full head of steam, and he's going to pick up the first down and maybe a couple more yards up near the 35-yard line. A gain of 3 on the play will give Lima a fresh set of downs in Raiders territory.
Give Runyon credit for executing that play. He caught the line sleeping on that. They were just waiting for him to come up. He just kind of moseyed up to the center, pinched him in a rear end, and off they went.
Runyon gives the play to Bott and Jay Johnson, who break out to the left, trips right. Runyon in the shotgun, takes a snap, looks to his right, under pressure, rolls away from it, and then throws towards the middle of the field, hits Kozad wide open. Kozad with a nice stutter step at the 22-yard line, but he can't get any positive yardage off of it. Going to be brought down at the 23, a gain of 13. It is enough for a Warriors first down as we hit the 9-minute mark left here in the first half. Raiders lead 7-0.
Well, Verrill Johnson stayed home on that play, read the pass, read the receiver, stayed home and made the tackle and kept the damage to what it is.
Runyon keeps Bott in the backfield to his left. No, now they're going to change dance partner side to the right. Three receivers to the right, one to the left. Runyon hands it off to Bott. Bott right down the left hash mark. He's able to get inside the Raider 20-yard line. Ardre Jarrett, Justin Ankley on the tackle. A gain of 4 brings up second down and 6 for Lima.
Yeah, that play went right over the hole between the left guard and tackle. I was talking earlier about how the defensive line did a good job at penetrating. That time they penetrated a little bit too much.
Empty backfield again. Runyon all alone standing at his 25-yard line. Quick pass out to the right side to Johnson, David Johnson, and right through his hands. Thrown a little high, but Johnson should have been able to haul that in. It'll bring up a third down and 6 for the Warriors.
That's called a wish pass. It's you wish you had another crack at it, because had he brought that ball down, he only had like 15 yards to the end zone.
Bott stays in the backfield to the left of Runyon. Three receivers to the top, one receiver to the bottom. Lima going right to left. Runyon takes a snap, hands it off to Bott. Bott slicing his way through. He's tripped up on the tackle for the Raiders. Jose Santiago gains a couple yards on it down to the 16-yard line. A gain of 3 will bring up a fourth down and 4 for Lima. And once again, no viable kicker made the trip, so Lima's forced to go for it in this situation.
Give Santiago credit for keeping his head up. He was on the ground when he made that tackle. He saw the runner come with the ball, grabbed an ankle, runner fell down. That's all he needed.
Trips right, Bott the lone back in the backfield to the left of Runyon in the shotgun. Takes the snap, pump fakes to his right, now under pressure, rolling out to his right, jumps in the air, makes the pass and completes it middle of the field. Kozad on the catch. Hendrickson brings him down very close to a first down. Looks like he might have gotten enough for it. Wait to see. Actually, the spot is more the 13 than the 12. It's going to be very close, and Joe Petrenis, though, is signaling first down, and so it'll be first and 10 for Lima. They picked up just enough, under 7 minutes to play in the first half.
That's not the first time Kozad's been the safety valve on a play. He's been out there in that flat a couple of times to pick off a ball as a secondary receiver.
Bott to the right of Runyon in the shotgun. Two receivers each side. Handoff goes to Bott. He tries the middle, and he's going to be tied up and driven back by Nate Harris and Brandon Hendrickson. Gets to the 10-yard line, a gain of 3. Will bring up second down and 7 for Lima. 6:20 to play in the first half. They trail 7-0.
Yeah, any number on a Raider jersey that started with a 5 was on a tackle. Good job by those two guys holding that run to where it was.
Going empty backfield for Lima. Three receivers right, two receivers off to the left. Runyon in the shotgun. Only two defenders over on the right side for the Raiders, for three receivers out there. Immediate pressure from Brandon Rogers. Runyon able to roll out to his right, get away from it, throws it back corner of the end zone, too high, intended for David Johnson. Bring up third down and 7 for Lima.
And guess who was out at the 3-yard line with nobody around him, pointing to his jersey? I should have had that. You should have thrown it to me. Kozad. He was open and alone again. You got to cover that guy.
Billy Kozad, 5'9", 183-pound receiver out of Kenton High School.
He's short enough that you can miss him.
Empty backfield again for Lima with 5:50 to play here in the first half, trailing 7-0, but threatening at the Raider 10-yard line. Runyon in the shotgun, takes a snap, under immediate pressure again, rolls out to his right, but dragged down from behind. Nate Harris with the sack for the Raiders, all the way back at the 21-yard line. A loss of 11 will bring up 4th and 18 for Lima.
It's very important that the defense keeps Lima off the board on this drive. 4th and 18, you got to get that ball back on downs, because the offensive, offensive side of the Raiders, you got to be honest, they've been sputtering a little bit so far.
Lima takes their final timeout of the half. Once again, Lima, no kicker for this road trip. So they're going to be forced to go for it. 4th and 19, ball on the 22-yard line. So it's pretty close to end zone or bust for Lima on this one.
I tell you, if I was Pivy, I'd say keep an eye on number one, because he's been finding a way to get open in those areas that he can do some real big damage. So it's going to be interesting to see what they come out with. The defense, obviously they're going to be reading pass, but they have to also seal that line too while they're doing it, to prevent a breakout.
Lima 0-for-6 on third down, but 2-for-4 on fourth down conversions thus far in the game. There have been 5 fourth down conversion attempts in the game, 4 by Lima, 1 by the Raiders. The Raiders were successful on their 1.
Well, that's the story of the game, of the offenses and defenses right now.
3 receivers to the right, 1 receiver to the left. That's Jay Johnson. Runyon with Bott to his right in the shotgun, takes a snap, drops back, has some time, now under pressure, rolls to his left, being chased by black jerseys, throws it up, picked off! Nate Hurd in the end zone, still on his feet at the 10, Hurd at the 20, brought down from behind at the 24-yard line on the tackle. Mike Macklin and Nate Hurd, in his first game as a Racine Raider, has an interception in the end zone, and Dave has something down on the sideline for us.
Talking to defensive backs coach today, Pedro Trevino, right before the game, and he said, yeah, we know that one of our guys in the secondary is gone from last year, but Nate Hurd, he's going to be a real big guy to step up this season. He's almost just as good as the aforementioned one that just left last season, that being David Earl. So keep your eye on Nate Hurd. Of course, a big play right there on fourth down with the big pick, stopping the Lima offense.
Raiders, thank you, Dave. Raiders offense out there. 2 receivers off to the right. The handoff goes to J.R. Taylor. He bounces off of a couple of tacklers in the backfield and is able to get some positive yardage to the 21-yard line. A gain of 2, second down and 8 with 5:10 to play in the half. Raiders lead 7-0.
Good short yardage play by the Raiders. A good blocking up front by the line for those 2 yards. They're well-earned 2 yards. You know, it's funny that when Pedro talked to Dave down there, he says, well, you know, mention too, it's my wife's birthday today.
Yeah, it's Pedro's wife's birthday. Chris Edwards' mom is celebrating a birthday today as well.
Guess what? It's not my birthday.
That's good. Hate to see you in your birthday suit. I mean, you've already got your shoes off. Receiver to the left, receiver to the right. I formation backfield. D'Elia to the right, in motion, right to left. Fakes the pitch to the fullback, Baskin, then gives it off to Taylor to the right side, and Taylor is upended, picks up a couple of yards, up to the 23, maybe 24-yard line. It's going to bring up a third down and long for the Raiders.
Got to give the Warrior defense credit on that one. The linebacking core didn't get faked by that fake pitch. They stayed home. They followed the ball, and met Nate right up there at the 20-yard line or thereabouts.
See the entire defense huddling over on the one of the benches in front of us, talking things over. Palmer to the left, D'Elia to the right, offset I formation backfield, Baskin offset to the right, Worthington the tight end on the right side of the formation, D'Elia in motion, fakes the pitch to Taylor under immediate pressure, getting out of the tackle is McClellan, throwing it up for D'Elia. D'Elia sat and waited for it, and it's picked off by Brandon Huddis, and they say he stepped out of bounds, and a couple of the Warriors players don't believe it, and that's Brant Huddis, excuse me. He steps out of bounds back at the 42-yard line, but it's going to be a turnover. The interception, D'Elia just did not attack that ball. He just sat there and waited for it to come to him, almost like a punt, Tom.
Well, you know, he didn't hear the footsteps coming up behind him, and that's exactly what had happened. Had no clue that the defender was just waiting, read that pass, and at the opportune time came on and said, excuse me, my ball, and took off.
So Lima will have the ball first and 10 at the Raiders' 42-yard line. No timeouts, 3:35 remaining in the first half. Raiders lead 7-0 off a 4-yard touchdown pass from Craig McClellan to Sam D'Elia on the opening drive of the game. Two receivers right, two receivers left. Kane Runyon in the shotgun. He has Jeremy Bott to his left. Looking to pass, looking to his right, now middle of the field, and throws it short of his intended receiver, Mike Macklin. Hash marks right side near the 25-yard line. It'll bring up second down and 10.
Not only short, but behind, because Macklin had to twist his hips in order to even get a hand touch the ball. That was an incomplete pass from the inception.
So the Raiders and the Warriors trade interceptions. And now Warriors ball, second and 10, 42-yard line of the Raiders with 3.5 minutes to play in the first half. Empty backfield for Runyon. Three receivers to the top, two to the bottom. Shotgun formation. Takes a snap, tries a quick pass. Intended receiver Jeremy Bott, left side, incomplete. Third and 10 for Lima.
Runyon was a little bit hurried on that pass. He had to unload that ball a little bit before he wanted to. And that resulted in the incomplete pass. Again, good work by the defensive line of the Raiders. They didn't penetrate hard, but they did enough to push that line back and force that pass.
Three receivers left, two to the right. Crowd gets into it on a third and 10. Empty backfield, Runyon in the shotgun. Drops back, looking to his left, may have been tipped at the line. A nice diving catch by David Johnson. He's immediately touched down by Laverl Johnson. Short of the first down, down to the 32-yard line. Maybe the 33. It's a gain of 9. It's going to bring up a 4th and 1 with 3 minutes to play in the first half.
You got to give him credit, Johnson credit, for catching that pass. He did a great athletic move by getting his arms on the ground and letting the ball fall into him.
2:50 to play in the first half. Under center is Runyon. He takes it, push back, but his second effort may have been enough to get him the first down. Raiders defensive line did a great job of standing up the Warriors offensive line, but a second effort by Runyon is going to make it really close to a first down. They're going to have to call for a measurement on this one, though, I believe. It's that close. Nope, they say first down. Got to the 32-yard line ball, the 32-yard line splitting the ball in half. Fresh set of downs for Lima.
Arguing he wants the measurement.
Little late now as they've moved the chains. Two receivers left, two receivers right. We're going to come to the two-minute warning. Why don't we take a 30-second timeout? A 30-second timeout. Raiders lead 7-0 at the two-minute warning. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
What's your routine? Everybody has one. Morning coffee, a donut, or your local paper? Add Ling's Sitco on Lathrop to your routine. Ling's is spotless, the people are friendly, and the coffee's always hot. And now Ling's is offering their free customer appreciation Sitco rewards program.
I am Dale Ling's. Stop in, meet me, and see how our reward card can save you money on things you buy every day.
You'll save on coffee and lots of other items, too, even gas. So sign up today. Make Ling Sitco on Lathrop Avenue Racine part of your routine.
We're a solid supporter of the Racine Raiders.
WRJN Racine Canada!
Looked like Coach Perfetto went onto the field. He wanted to know why he didn't get granted a measurement on that play there, Tom.
Yeah, I think Joe should have made that. Should have made the measurement on there. You know, it's not going to hurt. The sun isn't going to go down. You know, 2 hours late if they didn't do it. Sometimes you can eyeball it and say, yeah, you know, here it is on the line. There's the stick. You still got another half of football to play, so it's not going to make that much of a difference.
So a first and 10 at the Raider 32-yard line for the Warriors. 2 minutes to play in the first half. Warriors with no timeouts remaining. They come out with two receivers deep side. Runyon in the shotgun with Bott to his right. Didn't expect that snap. Is able to haul it in under pressure. Throws it up to the right. Kozad fell down and is able to come up with the completion down inside the 30-yard line. Looks like they're going to call it the 27, a gain of 5, second down and 5 for Lima.
The linebackers came up between the gaps between the tackles and guards, and there was no question about that. They were shooting the gaps and putting the pressure on it. Give Kozad credit for hanging on to that ball.
Trips to the near sideline, now going in motion, David Johnson. Now Runyon directing him back to the left side. So trips to the left, one receiver to the top. Runyon looking to his left, throwing across the middle of the field. Kozad with the completion, and Torrey Ruffin with a one-handed takedown. But it's going to be down to the 16-yard line, a gain of 11, and good enough for a Warriors first down.
Kozad's a dangerous guy. You can't let that guy get open.
Hurry up. Three receivers left, one to the right. Runyon looking to his left, middle of the field, knocked down. Big paw of Justin Ankley taking that ball to the ground, and it's going to bring up second and 10 with 55 seconds to play. Ball at the Raider 17.
There's one thing that both the defense, Raider defense and Lima offense know that they have to do. Defense knows they have to keep those points off the board. The offense has to put them on because of the Raider offense itself.
Same formation. Runyon in the shotgun. Bott to his right. Looking to his left where he had three receivers. Throws it out there. Knocked away. Knocked away by Laverl Johnson. Intended receiver Jay Johnson inside the 5-yard line brings up a third and 10.
Excellent coverage by Johnson, Laverl Johnson on that, timing it just right, getting into the arms of the receiver as that ball got there and breaking up that play.
49 ticks left, third and 10, ball at the Raiders 17-yard line. Three receivers left, one to the right, Runyon in the shotgun, Bott to his right. Looking to his left, under pressure, rolling out to his left, Jaron the Bullet Rutledge brings him down. For the sack back at the 26-yard line. A loss of 9, and it'll bring up 4th and 19 as the clock ticks down under 35 seconds to play.
Looked like Michael Ambrose got an assist on that tackle, too. The excellent swim move on the line for getting through and getting around the offensive lineman and making that sack.
20 seconds left to go. Lima will have to run a play. Two receivers right, two to the left, fourth and 19, ball at the Raiders 26. Runyon looking to pass, throws it out in and out of the hands of Jay Johnson on the coverage. Laverl Johnson for the Raiders. It'll be a turnover on downs, and with 8 seconds remaining, have to see if the Raiders decide to try and loft one up into the wind or just take a knee and go into the half with a 7-0 lead.
If I was coaching, I'd say nail it and go into the locker room and let's regroup. Let's get this offense fired up and going. The defense is doing an outstanding job at shutting down that Lima offense. And likewise, you got to give Lima credit for doing what they're doing to the Raider offense.
And Raiders with D'Elia as a safety back deep. It looks like they're just going to take a knee. We'll have to see if Dave on the sideline has one of the coaches for us, one of the coordinators. And it looks like he's going to be with defensive coordinator Chris Pivovar. Looks like they're going to take a knee here. And they do. So at the end of the first half, the Raiders lead 7-0. Why don't we send it down to Dave Tukesbrey, who is with defensive coordinator Chris Pivovar on the sidelines.
All right, thanks, Don. Coach, you're pitching a shutout so far defensively, a couple of big stops. Going into the break now, it's tied up. It's 7-0 right now. You got to be pleased with the way your defense has bowed their chest defensively.
Well, I think they've sucked it up, no question about that. What they need to do is get some oil in their joints, get some oil in their hips and their knees. But the other team has played 7 games, and I understand that. And they're a very good team to begin with. Lost 2 of the top teams in the country in close games. And so they're a skilled team. There's no question about that. But we just need to start getting our fluidity, if you will, get that machine oil and get it running smoothly, and we'd be all right. But so far they've stood up when they've had to stand up.
Coach, final question. Of course, you lose David Earl this past season, but Nate Hurd, he fills into that role. Big interception for him.
Well, Nate's got the opportunity to maybe step in there, and we don't skip much of a beat. David Earl was a fine football player. I've had the pleasure of coaching him in the pro ranks, and he was an excellent football player. And Nate Hurd has got the opportunity to be just as good as he was. We'll see.
All right, Coach. Thank you very much. Best of luck in the second half.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a
lot. Don, back up to you.
Thanks a lot for that report from the sideline, Dave.
Well, I tell you, they don't call Chris Pivovar the 10W40 coach for nothing, you know.
Why don't we take a break, and when we come back, we'll have our halftime interview with Racine Raiders offensive lineman Dan Morgel. Raiders lead 7-0 over the Lima Warriors at the half. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
The Racine Raiders halftime show continues now with our player interview, and it's offensive lineman Dan Morgel. Dan, no easy way to say this. You've been around the block with a lot of different teams. What keeps bringing you back year after year after year?
Well, this year is all my friends. Final season. All the guys are here. Everybody's back from last year except 2 starters. We got another chance to get a ring this year, so why not go out on top?
Now, you played with those great Kane County teams. You played with Racine now. What kind of comparisons can you make between the Kane County teams and the Racine team that we have here now today?
I'll say the biggest comparisons with Kane County wasn't really a family atmosphere. It was more a bunch of great players come together and play. Here, we got a lot of great players, and we play for each other, not just as an individual.
Now, you do some work with, like, the NFL Alumni Association, correct? What do you do with them with that Chicago region?
Well, I'm with the NFL Alumni. I do a lot of charity work with them. I'm also chairman of events for the NFL Players Association. I help set up the events. We do a lot of the PR, do a lot of charity, and we have our big golf outing on Tuesday this year.
How'd you get involved with that, and who can get involved with that?
I got involved. I was with the Chicago Bears on their practice squad for a couple seasons for part-time, and with that, as soon as you become an actual contracted player, you can join the Players Association. And as soon as I joined, I started doing some stuff, and the president nominated me to become the director of events.
Talk about your time with the Bears and on the practice squad. What does that all entail?
Basically, go to practice, a lot of hard work, trying to break that roster because the paycheck comes real big after that. I mean, at the time, you still make decent money, but nothing like you do once you make the roster.
This offensive line that the Raiders have, a pretty good mix of veterans and kind of some younger guys. Why don't you tell us a little bit about, like, guys like Chris Edwards, who people may not be as familiar with, and Wilton Jones, and what they bring to that line, and Ronald Lawless.
The Raiders offensive line is phenomenal. You got Chris on the outside, younger guy. He's got a lot of skill level, a lot of drive. I say he's asleep in the line. I mean, he seems nice, and he gets out there, and he just takes care of business. Wilton, he knows how to use his weight. He's been around for a while, too. He's about 380 pounds, and he moves. That's huge. You got Lawless in the center, probably one of the better guys I see out here with skill level. He knows how to stay low. He knows how to pop. Then on the other side of me, we've got Dusty. He's been around. He's been a Raider for a long time. He can play anywhere on the line. He doesn't want to play center anymore after his ring experiences, but he's good. Now we also picked up Matt Ryan to help out this year. He just came off his arena career and playing in Brazil. He's a huge addition.
Yeah, Matt, with that, with his time in Brazil, that playing, you know, 11-man football out there, and even helping coach, I believe he was out there doing that.
Yeah, absolutely. He just brings a lot of energy now. You know, we played with him for a couple years. Me and Dusty played with him in arena ball. Jaron has, a couple of the other defensive guys have. But going from arena back to outdoor, everything runs in slow motion. So it's kind of nice. He'll be in the rotation come second series tonight and work all the way through the line tonight.
Talk a little bit about that. You said King County had a great collection of great players, but maybe not the family atmosphere. But here in Racine, really kind of developed, it really gelled last year and brought that family atmosphere, guys having each other's backs, guys actually wanting to do things with one another and things along those lines.
Absolutely. With the family atmosphere, that's kind of the reason I came back for one last year. All the guys were coming back this year. We have a lot of guys returning after the season. So they're like, come on, let's do one more time here. We all have each other's back. You know, we're not out there. We push each other. So mess up on practice, we don't get down on them. We tell them how to fix it. We work with them, make them better. We got to have somebody to back us up. And if you get in their heads, you know, football is a lot of mental. So as long as we keep everybody on the positive side of it, we do well. And with the community loves us. We love the community. So it's nice.
You have experience being on the top and staying on the top for a number of years. What are you telling the younger guys here that, oh, we won our ring last year, you know, that chip is maybe kind of gone. What are you telling these younger guys about getting out there and getting after a second ring?
Well, the big thing is I told them, let's learn from the veterans that are here. Some of these guys are leaving this year. You guys want to come in, win some rings for years to come. Get the experience with these guys before they leave. Now come out here with the drive. We also have our drive. Chip's there. We had a bigger bullseye than we did last year. It's not everybody just wants to whoop on us. Last year, I thought we were overrated, but we've got some hardware to show that we weren't. So hopefully these guys take advantage of what we're trying to give them. Now, a lot of us work out together in the offseason here, too. And even now, I got two or three guys to come over and work out in my basement.
Now, you've blocked for some or played with some great quarterbacks in Kane County, some D1 guys. Where does Craig McClellan rate among the guys that you've played with at that quarterback position?
Craig last year, he's a smart quarterback, but he was a little slow last year in his reading process. He played some arena this year, really picked it up. You can see it out here now. He's up there on the levels. I mean, he started getting to the people like Sam Clemens. I mean, Sam Clemens is on a whole different level when you come out here. But I can see Craig making it to that level. He just needs more experience on this field, as well as going back to some arena ball.
Now, you go up against that defensive line every week in practice. Talk a little bit about that defensive line with Ardre Jarrett and Jaron Rutledge and Brandon Rogers and Larry Williams.
It's great going against our D-line because there's going to be no other team in this nation that has a D-line like this. Every one of the guys, I say on average, we're about 310 pounds across the front. They're huge. They all work out. It's tough. I mean, they're up there with NFL-sized guys in strength. So this is the best that we can possibly do. You got Ardre on the outside there. He's bringing it this year. He's been working out hard, running. You got Jaron, he's leaning down and bulked up at the same point. I mean, he's just a monster to begin with. You got Larry, he's probably put on a good 15 pounds of pure muscle and speed up. You got Brandon Rogers moved back to linebacker now. He's not on the line anymore, but you did move in. You got Big Jim. You got Ankley out here now. I mean, we got some studs on D-line. Problem is we got about 15 D-linemen, so we got to do something with that.
Now, as a veteran, obviously for younger guys, they can learn a lot from going up against these guys, and it really gives them that practice and that repetition of going up against the top. For you as a veteran, you've been up against some of the best already. You know, do you just kind of get to the point of, man, do I really have to go up against our own team like this?
You know, that's actually kind of fun because it's just bragging rights between us. You know, because we'll razz each other after it gets done. You know, it's nice because the veterans like to go against the veterans, and the rookies are kind of, those guys need to start to step up and go against these big boys, though, because that's only going to make them better.
Tom Wadewitz talking with Racine Raiders offensive lineman Dan Morgel during halftime of the Lima Warriors game. How bad was it? How you guys obviously wanted to get out here bad last week and hit another team.
Absolutely.
How disappointing was it to get that news that the Sioux Falls Stallions weren't showing?
I think the worst part about it is we found out via Facebook. They didn't even give us a call and let us know. We found out about 12:30 in the afternoon. So our whole morning, all of us players have been geared up prepping for the game. Then we find out, and now we're on hold until about 3 because they're trying to find somebody else to fill in. That was very disappointing. So today, we'll take it on these guys instead.
As an offensive lineman, what kind of goals do you set for yourself for the season? I mean, what are the goals that you actually go out and set?
The goals as an offensive lineman is the quarterback staying vertical. I mean, when it comes down to it, you keep everybody off the quarterback. We do well. You know, open up big holes. We got some horses in the backfield to take this ball to the end zone. So you get those running backs going. Next thing you know, the receivers are wide open. So, I mean, that's really our goals.
You've played on both sides of the ball. You've played indoor where you've had to probably play both sides as well. What do you prefer?
Honestly, I love indoor ball because it's faster. You know, outdoor ball, you got to average 4 to 5 seconds to throw a ball. Indoor ball, you got 2. And as a center in indoor ball, you're getting smacked as you're snapping the ball. So for me, I love that. I love the contact. I like the big hits. I like the energy. But there's still nothing like outdoor ball.
What does it mean to have most of the team returning from last year, plus a few extra studs that you guys were able to go out and recruit?
Oh, it's huge. I mean, we've already got the chemistry. We're going to have the team today has played 7 games. That's going to hurt us. So the plus side, we've got all but 2 starters coming back, and the guys that are filling in, they're a step up from what we even had last year. The only guy that really hurts that we don't have is David Earl. But Nate Hurd stepping up, wow. If we can get those two back out there together, though, that'll be sick.
All right, well, you got to get going. Any last thoughts?
Let's see these guys out tonight and get another ring this year.
All right, thanks for your time, Dan. Good luck this season.
Appreciate
that. Was Racine Raiders offensive lineman Dan Morgel. We will return in 60 seconds. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN. We're at the half. The Raiders lead the Lima Warriors 7-0 as they just turned on the lights. It's getting a little dark out, and so they wanted to conserve some energy. And the lights are firing up and should be ready to go for the start of the second half. But the Raiders with that 7-0 lead, they got on the first drive of the game. Craig McClelland, who was 3-for-3 for 61 yards on that drive, hit Sam D'Elia for a 4-yard pass, and that was the Raiders' lone score and the lone score of the half. McClelland finished the half 5 of 11, 89 yards, 1 TD, and 1 interception. He also had 2 carries for 3 yards. J.R. Taylor, the leading rusher in the game, 7 carries for 20 yards. Floyd Underwood, 3 for 6 yards. Palmer, the leading receiver, 2 catches for 57 yards. Dom Kegel has 2 catches for 28 yards. For Lima, Runyon, 11 for 24, for 90 yards, no touchdowns, 1 interception. And Jeremy Bott, 6 carries for 11 yards. Runyon, 2 for 4. Zach Jackson, 2 for 2. Kozad, the leading receiver for the Warriors, 6 catches for 49 yards. Bott, 2 for 19. Johnson, 2 for 13. And Macklin, 1 for 9. Lima with 7 first downs to just 6 for the Raiders. 10 rushes for 17 yards for Lima, 13 for 29 for the Raiders. 69 passing yards for Lima, 72 for Racine. 38 plays for 86 yards for the Warriors, 26 for 101 for the Raiders. That's an average per play of 2.3 yards for Lima, 3.9 for the Raiders. Each team has an interception, and the Raiders had a fumble, but they were able to hold on to it. 3 penalties for 40 yards for the Raiders, 1 for 5 for Lima. And something you're not going to see very often, Tom, at the half, both teams with exactly 15 minutes time of possession.
Yeah, that's... Are you sure that computer's right?
Let me hit the monitor.
Hit the monitor. You know, yeah, okay, like you had the right hammer.
Maybe I should go hit the statistician and make sure it's right, too. So, Paul Junior doing a great job on stats as well.
Did you say hit him with a hammer, too?
Sure.
15, you know, that's a quarter each. What I'm looking at...
You're brilliant.
I went to school, too. Penalties, again, Raiders, 33 penalties for 40 yards. You know, a couple of those were...
The intentional grounding was a big one.
Yeah, you know, you can't have those kind of penalties. Another thing that I'm looking at, too, Billy Kozad, 6 receptions, 49 yards. That guy's dangerous. He can find a way to get open in the middle of traffic and catch a ball. They got to keep an eye on him. What's got to happen in the second half, and hopefully they talked about it, the Raider offensive line has to fire up. They've got to get aggressive. They got to start getting, you know, gritty in there. Their gaps are a little bit too wide. Looking at it, there's a pretty good sized gap between the right guard and the center. They got to seal those gaps off a little bit. They've got to get more aggressive in the line play.
Once again, we're at the half as the captains meet out at midfield for the start of the second half. The Raiders lead 7-0 over the Lima Warriors. The Warriors will start the second half with the ball. The Raiders will be kicking off as the Warriors won the coin flip and deferred to the second half of play.
I had to get a kick out of, Pivy talking about, getting oil in their joints. And that's exactly, I know exactly what he's talking about. You know, they know the stuff, they know the routine, they're stiff. They've got to loosen up. They've got to explode. That's what he was alluding to. And he's absolutely right. They can do the job. They've demonstrated it. They've shut down the Warrior offense. They got to open it up a little bit too.
The Warriors will be going right to left. They'll have the wind with their at their backs to begin the second half of play, trailing 7-0. Joel DePras out there to kick off. Raiders in their black jerseys with silver numerals outlined in white, black helmets with the Raider Guy logo, silver pants with black piping, white and black socks for the Raiders. Lima in their, they're more kind of a silver jersey with their black accents, silver pants, silver helmets with their Lima Warriors logo. As we're about ready to get underway, Joel DePras approaches the ball, and it's a nice kick by DePras, going to be taken, actually muffed as two Warriors fight for it at the 15-yard line. Finally picked up by David Johnson, and he's going to be ripped down by Torrey Ruffin.
Yeah.
Forward progress looks to get him maybe to the, now they're going to say at the 10-yard line, so it'll be a first and 10 from the 10, as it's going to be a loss of 5 yards on that return.
Yeah, forward progress. I was going to call that backward progress. A muff on the kickoff, and boy, that's starting out dangerous right there. And Torrey was right there to make the tackle and put Lima in a very, very precarious situation early in the second half.
You sound like a politician. Backward progress.
Backward progress. Yeah, you want to vote for me?
Two receivers to the left, one receiver, two receivers to the right as well. Shotgun formation for Runyon. Jeremy Bott to his right. Runyon standing right at his 5-yard line. Takes a snap, gives it to Bott. A big hole opened in the middle. Bott runs through it and gets across the 10 up to the 12-yard line. It ends up being just a gain of 2. Good job by the Raiders linebackers on closing that gap quickly. It's going to bring up a second down. They're going to say a gain of 3. Second down and 7 for Lima.
Brandon Hendrickson was in on that tackle. Very instrumental in reading that play and shutting it down after he saw the runner come through the hole.
Same formation. Runyon in the shotgun with Bott to his right. Two receivers to each side. Drops back, looking to pass, has time, right side. Ball may have been tipped at the line and high, intended for Macklin. Justin Benko and Nate Hurd over on the coverage, right at the numbers at the 20-yard line, far sideline, brings up a 3rd and 8.
That pass had a little bit of power to it. I don't think anybody could have caught it. Justin got some fingers on it, may have deflected it, but even though it had some oomph on it, and it would have been a very hard pass to catch.
Trips to the near side. Two receivers to the right. Empty backfield for Runyon on 3rd and 8. Just underway here in the second half. Pump fakes to his right. Under pressure. Going to be brought down.
Ball
loose. Ankley with the strip. And the Raiders look to have recovered. Jumping on the ball. The big man. R.J. Jarrett. And the Raiders are set up. The table is set. First and goal at the 5-yard line for Racine. Actually, right at the 5.
Justin Ankley did an outstanding job bringing the quarterback down on that play. He didn't strip the ball, but the way he brought the quarterback down, he landed on his arm and the ball popped right out. Just outstanding play work. The defense gave the offense a gift. Let's take advantage of it.
Second turnover of the game for the Warriors. Raiders come out, offset I formation, backfield. D'Elia to the right, Palmer to the left. McClellan gives it to Taylor. Taylor slashing through the right side is going to be just short. Pickup of about 4. It'll bring up 2nd and goal from the 1.
And they must have talked about those gaps on the offensive line, because looking at it from up here, those gaps between the center and a guard got a little bit tighter on this first series of plays. And, the coaches up here may have been looking at the same thing. You got to close it up, and it paid off.
Check that. They mark it down at the 2-yard line. 2nd down and goal at the 2. Cullend under center gives it to Taylor again, and Taylor denied the end zone, trying the right side. Got some pressure in the backfield. It looked to be on the initial contact Chris Brooks for Lima, and it'll bring up third and goal from the two.
Give Lima, the defensive line, current line for Lima, credit for making it tough for the offensive line for the Raiders to do some penetration. That tackle came from the outside.
Straight eye formation now for the Raiders with Baskin and Taylor. McClelland audibles. Palmer to the left, D'Elia to the right. Worthington tight end right side of the formation. McClelland with the pitch to Taylor. Taylor is going to get stood up and dropped down in the backfield. A loss of 3 yards back to the 5-yard line. And it's going to bring up a third and goal, or fourth and goal from the five. And on comes Joel Duprat for a chip shot field goal. And this one should go for 22 yards. Check that, 24 yards where they're going to set it down.
Golden opportunity by the Raider offense. Did not take advantage of it. Have to settle for three. It's points, but, hey, you could have had more out of it.
And they need one more person out there. Worthington runs out. Feast the holder instead of Kegel this time. Raiders ready. They're going to set it down on the 13, a 23-yard field goal attempt, and he splits the uprights. The Raiders take a 10-0 lead with 12:02 to play in the third quarter. We'll be back after this commercial break. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN.
Duprat with a high kick fielded at the 20-yard line by Yancey Donald, and Donald taken down at the 25, they're going to say 26, a gain of 6 on the return. It'll be first and 10 for Lima at the 26-yard line, their own.
Excellent special teams coverage by the Raiders on that play, keeping on the kickoff, keeping the Warriors down to their 25. Again, another situation where if the defense can keep them down there and do some damage, they're giving the offense the opportunity. Boy, the Warriors had to be going to the bench after that last series, saying, we're glad it was only 3 points.
Three receivers to the right, one receiver to the left. Bott to the left of Runyon, who's in the shotgun for Lima. Under 12 minutes to play in the third quarter. Raiders lead 10-0. Takes a snap, looking to pass, middle of the field, picked off. Brandon Hendrickson at the 32. Hendrickson on his feet at the 30, bowling over the offensive players and diving to the 25-yard line. The Raiders have the ball in Lima territory. First and 10 at their 25. The third turnover of the game for the Warriors, and turnovers on consecutive drives here in the second half.
When I saw the Warriors coming out of that huddle and set up the formation, I was looking, where's Billy Kozad? Where's Billy Kozad? And sure enough, he came in from the slot back, did an angle in pass. Guess who the pass was intended for? Billy Kozad. He had coverage, though, on that play. Coming from the back, he heard footsteps, got a little nervous, allowed for the interception.
Now the Raiders need to punch this one into the end zone. Palmer to the left, D'Elia to the right, offset eye formation, backfield behind McClelland. Takes a snap, fakes the handoff, backside pressure, gets it off. Travis Worthington, touchdown Raiders. Middle of the field, 25 yards from Craig McClelland. And Racine leads 16-0, just like that, 11:38 to play in the third quarter.
Outstanding pass by Craig McClelland. He had heat on him coming in the form of Chris Brooks. He got around from the end, and he almost broke up that pass. Craig stayed in there, found the open receiver, and made something out of it.
And Travis Worthington, I think, too busy celebrating, doesn't realize they need him out there for the field goal or extra point attempt. John Sturba runs out there. Now they get Dorian Palmer out there, too, as apparently the Raiders were a couple short. Eric Feast directing traffic on where everybody should be, lining them up. Josh Willis, the long snapper. Feast, the holder. Snap is good. Hold is down. Kick is up. And the Raiders lead 17-0 with 11:38 to play in the third quarter. We'll be back after this commercial break. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN.
Praz kick taken at the goal line and brought out near the 30-yard line on the return. Trying to see 85 David King. David King, and I believe Dave has something on the sideline for us with the Raider down. We'll get you information on that in a minute.
Yeah, Don, Brandon Hendrickson, of course, with that huge interception. You also might note that Ardre Jarrett wasn't on the field for that defensive series. He's cramping up on the sidelines. His return is questionable, but he's got his shoulder pads off right now. It looks pretty doubtful, guys.
Yeah, I think that last touchdown might have solidified whether he'll see any playing time in this one since the Raiders were able to score quickly.
And it, it's a first game. It is the, guys cramp up. You're gonna be a little bit lenient on that. You're not going to push them too much like you would in a regular season game. They're up by 17 points. The defense have shown that they can control this Lima offense. The Raider offense came around and put some, insurance points up on the board to make it a little bit more comfortable game than what we saw in the first half.
Injured Raider on the play, number 34, Sandal Quarter, a defensive lineman, as the training staff is working on him. The athletic trainers for the Raiders are out there. Christian Venegas, Mike Hote, and Claire Botting out there for the Raiders. They're the athletic trainers for the team, doing an excellent job once again for the organization as they get Quarter flipped around from laying on his front side to laying on his back side as they are looking at what appears to be either his right or left leg.
They are from the firm of Doctors of Physical Therapy, a new PT firm around the area, and all the therapists are doctorate level trained. So we're glad to have them with the Raiders this year.
Want to remind everyone too, if you don't have dinner plans already for Monday, the Texas Roadhouse is having a donation night, Texas Roadhouse at Highway 11 and Highway 31 in Racine. If you stop in between 4 p.m. and close, the proceeds from your food purchase will be donated to the Raiders organization. And typically that's going to be done the first Monday of every month, but this time they're going to do it this upcoming Monday as they decided on this a little late on that they're going to do this as a running thing to do it for last Monday's date. So they're going to do the second Monday this week, but then it'll be the first Monday in August.
We appreciate their support too for all their work with the Raiders and their efforts.
They have Quarter up and he's being helped off the field and he is putting no pressure on that left leg right now, it looks like.
That looks like it hurts.
Yeah.
A little bit more pressure, but hey, it's probably safe to say that he's going to be taken off the pads for the rest of the game.
Yeah. And I'm sure Dave will get us a report on what happened to Sandal Quarter out there in this one. But it's going to be Lima ball, first and 10 at their own 30-yard line, 11 and a half minutes to play in the third quarter. The Raiders have gotten turnovers on back-to-back drives, and they've turned them into 10 quick points here in the second half.
10 quick points that they needed to get to put some padding on the scoreboard. And again, you can't say enough about Billy Kozad, the way that he can get himself open. And apparently they talked about this guy at halftime in the locker room saying, we got to cover this guy. And first two series, the Raider defense did an excellent job at doing that.
It's going to be empty backfield for the Warriors as you hear the Quarter getting a round of applause from the Raiders fans. Two receivers right, three to the left. Runyon in the shotgun. Takes a snap, quick pass to his left. To Jay Johnson. Johnson with the catch, and then he gets tied up, is able to break out of it, but brought down. Tracy Baskin and Justin Benko take him down at the 35-yard line. Picks up 5 yards on about 20 yards of running, and it'll bring up second down and 5 for Lima.
That was a hard-earned 5 yards that he got out of that play. Good penetration by the Raider defense. And maybe a little bit too much. They should have smelled screen pass on that situation. It kind of looked like a screen pass, too.
Three receivers to the Raider sideline, one to the top. Shotgun formation for Runyon. He has Bott to his left. takes a snap. The handoff goes to Bott, cutting across the right, slips out of a Scott tackle and is going to pick up the first down and more across the 45 up to the 46, maybe even 47-yard line, a gain of 12 on the play, and it'll be a fresh set of downs for Lima.
The reason that he couldn't be brought down because he did exactly what every backs coach tell you to do. Keep your feet moving. As long as your feet are moving, you're not going to get tackled, and that's exactly what he did, and he got the first down for Lima. Lima. I said Lima again.
Three receivers left, one receiver right. Shotgun for Runyon, Bott to his right. 10 minutes to play in the third quarter. Runyon looking to pass under pressure, lofts it up towards the Lima sideline. Nobody there, and it falls incomplete. Looking for a flag is Jeremy Bott, who is tied up by Jordan Scott as he was trying to come out of the backfield. No flag. It's going to be second down and 10.
Yeah, they were looking at it, and that time he asked the back judge, do you have somebody around you? And apparently there was somebody close enough to the ball that he said, yeah, no, it was an incomplete pass.
Trips left, one receiver to the top. That's Macklin. Runyon moves Bott from his right side to his left side. He's in the shotgun. Hands it off to Bott. Bott with a little counter step and is going to be tied up by a lot of black jerseys, including Justin Ankley, Brandon Hendrickson, and also in on that one, Marcus Fletcher. It's going to be a loss of a couple of yards back to the 44-yard line and bring up third down and 12 for Lima.
Well, it's a good thing they blew the whistle to kill that play, because if Bott had gone down with all those bodies on him, he wouldn't have needed a stepladder to get out of that hole.
Same formation. Bott to the right of Runyon, who's in the shotgun. Devron Davis looking blitz from the outside on the right side. He backs into coverage. Runyon under pressure, rolling out to his right, running for his life. He's going to keep it. Crosses midfield, hit as he goes out of bounds by Davis. Close to a first down. Have to see where they mark it. Think he's going to be just short at the 45-yard line. As it's a gain of 11, we'll bring up fourth down and one for Lima.
Give Runyon credit, because I don't know if it was skilled athleticism or survival, because he had a lot of black shirts coming down on him, and he got out of it, and he made, kind of a silk purse out of a sow's ear.
Three receivers to the left, two to the right. Runyon all alone. He's going to come to the line on fourth and one. He keeps it, tries the left side, a flag comes out, and it looks like initially he got enough yardage. We'll have to see what the flag's for.
I'm betting this may go the other way, because that center looked like he was way over the ball beyond.
Yancey Donald signals against the Raiders. Waiting for the official call.
Offside Racine.
So that's the first down for Lima via penalty.
You have to turn on your mic to get it. I know. So it's the pot.
It'll be a first and 10 at the 40-yard line for Lima, the 40 of the Raiders. Three receivers to the left, one to the right. Bott to the left of Runyon, who's in the shotgun. Under 9 minutes to play in the third quarter. Raiders lead 17-0. Takes a snap. Handoff goes to Yancey Donald. Donald tries the middle, and he's going to be tied up by a lot of beef, and that beef is named Eric Starks. Going to be no gain. It'll bring up second down and 10.
Yeah, Eric got him in the grasp and didn't let hold of him, let go of him, and that play ended where Eric said hello.
The attendance at tonight's game?
I bet you it's 1249.
1,250. No, 1,249.
Who did you see climb over the wall?
Two receivers to each side. Shotgun formation for Runyon. Takes the snap under pressure. Throws it to the left. Catch is made by David Johnson, but he pays. the hit by Torrey Ruffin. Good job of holding on to the ball by Johnson. Yardage to the 36-yard line. That was a rough, they're going to say 35, a rough 5 yards on that play for David Johnson.
He's going to go back to the huddle, and they're going to say, nice catch. He's going to say, I don't want the next one. He really got nailed by Torrey.
Third and 5, 7.5 minutes to play in the third quarter. Lima has the ball at the Raiders' 35-yard line. Their last two drives have ended via a turnover. Three receivers right, two to the left. Empty backfield for Runyon. Looking, quick pass out to the right. He's able to hit Marvin Germany. Germany with the first down and more inside the Raider 25-yard line. Down the far numbers, a gain of 11 to the 24 and a fresh set of downs for the Warriors.
The three receivers on for the Warriors is working out for them, and they realize it because the middle receiver is doing a straight down pass pattern, the inside receiver is doing an angle in, and the far receiver is just kind of staying home. And the quarterback's got three potentials to pick out from on that side.
Two receivers to each side. Runyon shotgun formation. Bot to his left. Looking to his left side. Under pressure from Jaron Rutledge. Rolls out to the right. Throws it complete down to the 10-yard line. And on the catch, Billy Kozad. A gain of 15 and a first down for Lima. And Dave has something for us on the sideline.
Yeah, guys, they were taking a look at Sandal Quarter. They're icing down his ankle. And they're calling it a left ankle sprain right now. His return is doubtful. Don.
Thank you very much for that injury update, Dave. 6 minutes to play in the third quarter. It's a first and goal at the 10-yard line for Lima. They trail 17-0. Two receivers to each side. Runyon in the shotgun. Bot to his left. The handoff to Bot on the counter to the right side. Going to pick up about 4 yards on the play down to the 6-yard line. It'll bring up second and goal from the 6 for Lima.
Billy Kozad's kind of like that sleeper that's on that side because he takes a couple of steps out and the back's back up to cover him. They know what the damage he can do. And what happens, the running back just comes right up that hole and he sees that the linebackers and the safeties are backing up a little bit and they take advantage of it.
5:15 to play in the third quarter. Second down and goal. Ball at the 6-yard line. Two receivers on each side again. Bot to the right of Runyon this time. Runyon in the shotgun. Looking to his left. Now looking to his right. Throws it. Nobody home. Nobody in the area.
Nobody was there.
And it's going to be a third and goal from the 6-yard line. Runyon throws his hands up in the air. And looks like I believe that was Jay Johnson throws his hands up in the air and everybody's mad at everybody.
And it would look like somebody was supposed to be doing an angle out pass on or a pattern on that pass and forgot.
Check that. That was Marvin Germany throwing his hands up.
Billy Kozad's over on that side too.
He's in the slot on the right side. David Johnson slot left, wide left, Jay Johnson. Shotgun formation, Runyon, Bot to his right. Third and goal from the 6-yard line. 4:53 to play in the third quarter. Raiders lead 17-0. Hand off to Bot, and Bot is going to force his way into the end zone, running through a tackle attempt by Brandon Rogers and taking Nate Harris for a ride. And Lima is on the board. It's 17-6 with 4:46 to play in the third quarter. That drive going 11 plays, or check that, 12 plays for 70 yards and taking up 6 minutes and 52 seconds.
That was a good play call on that particular play because the Warriors have been pounding the Raiders with those left-sided passes, short passes, inside fly to the sideline, and to give it to Bot to go right up the middle this time, it was a great sleeper play.
Once again, no kicker made the trip for Lima, so they have to go for two. Two receivers right, two to the left. Runyon in the shotgun. This time he has Bot in front of him and off to the left. Bot's going to come out of the backfield. Runyon throwing in the corner of the end zone. No good. Overthrows his intended receiver, David Johnson. Torrey Ruffin on the coverage. The two-point conversion pass fails, and the Raiders lead 17-6 with 4:46 to play in the third quarter. We'll be back after this commercial break. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN.
Well, with having no kicker used to kicking off a tee, it's going to be Mike Macklin doing the free kick. He's going to be punting it off.
Not in the rule book says you can't do that.
And now the Raiders, apparently they didn't bring a tee. Maybe Macklin does want a tee, and the Joel DePra is being kind enough to give Macklin a tee.
Maybe he rented it to him. Yeah, $10 here. You can use my tee, $10.
But he had to have something to start out the game. Maybe they gave it to him to begin the game, too.
Yeah.
So now Macklin sets the ball on the tee at the 35-yard line. Raiders are set. Back deep, Demonche Pitt, Torrey Ruffin, and Demetrius Thompson standing at the Raiders' 15-yard line. Pitt back at inside the 5. Squib kick gets by Steve Kleist, and colliding are Torrey Ruffin and Devron Davis, and Davis takes the ball and runs up the Raiders' sideline and steps out of bounds, knocked out of bounds at the 42-yard line. It'll be Raiders' ball first and 10 at their own 42.
You know, for not having a kicker, those are the kind of kicks that are really dangerous because they squib off the ground, they bounce, and who knows where that ball's going to end up, hitting somebody or muffing it or whatever. So Raiders made something good out of that kickoff.
Talking to Mike Johnson, longtime Raider fan during halftime, and he said that his wife Marnie is celebrating a birthday tomorrow, so happy birthday to Marnie as they're listening to the broadcast right here at Horlick Field. Receivers to each side, offset eye formation backfield. Pitt is the deep back. The handoff goes to Pitt. Pitt trying to get the corner. He does. Pitt at midfield steps along the sideline, but they say he actually stepped out short of midfield at the 49. A gain of 7 will bring up second down and 3 for the Raiders with 4:35 to play in the third quarter.
Pitt had that stiff arm that gave him those extra yards, and give him credit for making the effort of trying to stay in bounds, but cutting that corner the way he did. He lost his balance a little bit and just couldn't do it.
Pitt is lightning. Kegel to the right, Palmer to the left. Palmer in motion, left to right, offset eye to the left side. Pitt the deep back, handoff to Pitt. Pitt down the left hash marks, and he dives forward for a first down into Lima Warriors territory. They're going to mark him down at the 46-yard line, a gain of 5, but a fresh set of downs for the Raiders.
I'm impressed with the Raider offensive line this half. They buttoned it up. They're looking good. They're executing. They're shooting out and making the blocks that they have to.
See, Matt Ron is out there at right tackle for the Raiders. He's getting some playing time, as they must be resting Dusty Swenson a little bit. Kegel in motion. Pitch goes to Demonche Pitt. Pitt leaps a defender. Pitt on his feet at the 40, down to the 35-yard line. A pickup of 11 for Demonche Pitt. And the Raiders move the chains again. First and 10 Racine in Lima territory at their 35 with 3.5 minutes to play in the third quarter. Raiders lead 17-6.
You got to give credit to number 24, Demetrius Thompson, for making Pitt look good on that play. He laid out two good blocks that allowed Pitt to come out to this near sideline and get that yardage that he did.
Demonche Pitt, 3 carries for 23 yards. That's also the plays and yardage on this drive. He's had it all. Kegel to the right, Palmer to the left, I formation backfield. Deep back is Pitt. Pitt takes the handoff, and this time he's crunched. Maybe picks up a yard. It'll bring up second down and 9. One of the tacklers, Yancey Donald, for Lima.
That was interesting because the offensive line on the Raiders fired out, and I think the tackler just came over the top and ended up on top of Pitt. It may have been a surprise that he made the tackle.
Raiders, same formation as they break the huddle. Sturba, the tight end, on the right side of the formation. McClelland audibles, and Sturba takes a head start. It's going to cost the Raiders 5 yards, and it'll be second down and 14.
trying to apply Canadian football rules here.
And it is a false start. Rave moves the Raiders back to the 39-yard line. Second down and 14 for Racine.
The Raiders are moving the ball. They are controlling it, these series of downs that they've had so far this half, something that they had a hard time doing in the first half.
Sturba moves to the left side of the formation. Pitt takes a handoff and gets outside to the left and is brought down. A hard hit out there at the 35-yard line. A gain of 4 on the play back to the original line of scrimmage. Going to make it third down and 10 with 2:15 to play in the third quarter.
What you see the Raiders doing right now is eating up a lot of clock. You know, if you had J.R. Taylor back there, he'd be busting out, getting, you know, a bigger guy busting out, getting more yardage. Demonte Pitt, he's doing an excellent job getting the little stuff and keeping that clock going.
Palmer to the left again, Kegel to the right. Sturba, tight end, right side of the formation. Third and 10, 1:45 to play. McClellan looking to pass, lost it up. A flag comes out and nothing happened. It was intercepted, but they're going to say whatever it was, probably a false start occurred before the play.
Yeah, that was interesting. I hope it was a false start because they can rethink about what they did on that play because those defensive ends came around awfully quick to get to McClellan.
A false start against the Raiders moves them back 5 yards. It'll bring up third and 15, ball at the 40-yard line. 1:41 to play in the third quarter. Raiders lead 17-6. The first two possessions, Lima possessions of the half, the Raiders had an interception and a fumble recovery and turned those into 10 points. Lima then went down the field and got a touchdown on their third possession, and the Raiders trying to answer here. Receivers deep side, offset eye to the right. Fakes the handoff to Pitt. McClellan looking to pass under pressure. He's going to be brought down all the way back at midfield. And on the tackle, on the sack, Andrew Peel. And they're going to say all the way back to the 48-yard line, a loss of 12 on the play. That's going to bring Joel DePra out to punt.
I think Coach Nelson is going to have a talk with his defensive front four or front five up there. You can't really blame the center. He's got a lot of work to do. But the other four guys, when you see penetration by the defense like that and your defensive line is still standing up, somebody or four guys missed something, and I think Coach Nelson's going to be talking to him about it.
And Lima has to waste a timeout on a punt as they had too many men on the field and they need to get organized. And this is one of the problems when you travel, Tom. You don't necessarily have your usual cast of characters, and so not everybody knows, hey, oh, I'm supposed to be out there on special teams, on punt return or on punt block or something along those lines, and you don't have enough guys or you have too many.
Yeah, and like I mentioned before, on the games that we've seen that we've been on to, that you've had to travel a pretty good distance like Lima had to do today, you'd come with a short bench. Like you mentioned, you don't have everybody that's playing together, and it is confusing. You know, being in the league that we're in this year, the MSFL, playing teams that are only an hour away at the most, we're not going to see that. It's going to be a full bench.
Billy Kozad back deep to receive the Joel DePra punt. DePra standing inside his 35-yard line. Josh Willis, the long snapper. Snap is a little off to the right. DePra gets it off, nearly blocked by Chris Brooks. And on the return, Kozad brought down immediately by Torrey Ruffin at the 26-yard line. So the punt goes for 26 yards into that wind on the net. It'll be a first and 10 for Lima. They trail 17-6, 45 seconds remaining in the third quarter.
That last offensive series that Lima ran and scored on the touchdown, they found something that was working. Hopefully the defense, when they sat on the bench this time, they were able to figure it out and counter it. And again, they go to the three wideouts and who knows where the ball's going to go.
Two wideouts to the right, two to the left. Shotgun formation for Runyon. He has Bott to his right. Fakes a handoff to Bott, and maybe it was supposed to be a handoff. Bott took off. Runyon had to salvage the play and just ran forward, picks up a few yards, a couple yards, the 29-yard line, a gain of two. It'll bring up second down and eight for the Warriors.
Yeah, I think you call that right one down. The Bob was supposed to get the ball and ran right by Runyon and one that wasn't in the playbook.
15 seconds left to play here in the third quarter. Runyon checks his wristband. Three receivers to the near side, one to the far side. Bot to the right of Runyon in the shotgun. Takes a snap, looking to his left. Pump fakes, pulls it back, throws it up. Catch is made by David Johnson. He splits the defenders. Johnson the 30, the 20, and Torrey Ruffin brings him down with one arm, down at the 14-yard line. And it's a huge gain of 55 yards as the third quarter comes to an end. And Lima is going to have the ball first and 10 at the Raider 14-yard line when we return for the fourth quarter. But the Raiders have the lead, 17-6. We'll be back after this break. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
All dealerships pay the same price when it comes to purchasing a vehicle from the manufacturer. So what makes your buying experience different at Martin's Family of Dealerships in Union Grove? The ability to purchase a vehicle with only the equipment you want and without the unnecessary pre-installed add-ons that increase your bottom line. It's our guarantee to you. You won't find any added frills or inflated markups. That's our promise, because at Martin's, it's better business. What's your routine? Everybody has one. Morning coffee, a donut, or your local paper? Add Ling's Sitco on Lathrop to your routine. Ling's is spotless, the people are friendly, and the coffee's always hot. And now Ling's is offering their free customer appreciation Sitco Rewards Program.
I am Dale Ling. Shop there, meet me, and see how our reward cards and baby money are
longest.
You'll save on coffee and lots of other items, too, even gas. So sign up today. Make Ling's Sitco on Lathrop Avenue Racine part of your routine.
We're a proud supporter of the Racine Raiders.
WRJN Racine Canada.
So Lima ends the third quarter with their longest pass play of the season. Now they're at the Raiders' 15-yard line. Hand off to Bott. Bott tries the middle of the field. Jordan Scott is going to bring him down. Some help from Brandon Hendrickson out there. And it also looks like Michael Ambrose. It's going to be no gain on the play. And they're going to actually say a loss of a couple. Second down and 11 or 12 for Lima. Ball now at the 16-yard line of the Raiders.
Hendrickson coming off the field with a limp and waving his hand, get somebody in here for me. Must have got stepped on the ankle or something like that. The defense knows they have to button this one up and keep Lima off the board.
We'll send it to Dave on the sideline after this play. Three receivers to the left, one to the right. Runyon in the shotgun, looking to pass, under pressure, rolling out to his right. Heavy pressure, throws the middle of the field and off the hands of Jeremy Bott. Incomplete. Bring up third down and 12, and we'll send it to Dave on the sideline.
Don Ardre, Jarrett, not the only Raider tonight who is cramping up. Brandon Hendrickson, as you guys just mentioned, he just came off the field as well with some cramps. His return is questionable.
Yeah, Brandon's been trying to get healthy coming back from an injury, and so no surprise there that having to play in the full game in his first game that he starts to cramp up on not a warm night, but still warm enough when it's your first action.
It's starting to get cool and damp, too.
Two receivers right. Three receivers to the left. Empty backfield for Runyon in the shotgun on third and 12. Takes a snap. Immediate pressure from Ankley. Ankley hits him, gets the pass off. It's complete to Johnson, David Johnson, and he's taken down after a pickup of a couple. Back to the original line of scrimmage, maybe not even quite. We'll call it actually a gain of one. It's going to bring up fourth and 11 for Lima. Once again, no kicker on this trip, so they're forced to go for it here. Fourth and 11 at the Raiders' 15-yard line.
That play was designed to be a quick look-in pass with the receiver curling in and going straight up. Luckily, the defensive secondary for the Raiders read that play, stayed home, and came up and made the tackle at the line of scrimmage.
And Lima is going to take a timeout to talk this one over. Their second timeout of the half. They have one remaining. 13:41 left to play in this one. The Raiders lead Lima 17-6. Raiders trying to improve to 2-0 on the season after last week's forfeit victory over the Sioux Falls Stallions and extend their winning streak to 16 straight games and also go to 25-0 against teams from Ohio.
You know, I'm sorry, but, you know, forfeit victory is, you know, like having to kiss your sister. You know,
not going to argue with you, but a win's a win.
Yeah, I know a win's a win, but you wanted to play football. Yeah. We wanted to be out here.
You know, my issue with that is there's all these ranking places, and that team did not take a hit in the rankings for not showing up. And my personal thought is if you forfeit a game and it's a non-league game so there's no recourse for the other team, you should just be ineligible for any rankings in any postseason play outside of your league.
You need to
have something, some punishment for these teams that do this.
Or you go down two slots or something like that.
So it's going to be 4th and 11. Ball at the Raider 15-yard line. 13:41 to play. Raiders lead 17-6. Runyon with a back to his left, a back to his right. Two receivers bunched just off the line on the left side. Marvin Germany split out to the right. Runyon takes it. The backs both leave the backfield. Being chased from behind, slips the Brandon Rogers tackle. Throw into the corner of the end zone, incomplete. Lots of traffic over there, and it's going to be a turnover on downs. No flags on the play. The Raiders will take over at their own 15-yard line. The second time this game that Lima has turned the ball over on downs.
To say that Runyon was under pressure is an understatement. He had a lot of heat coming down on him. He knew it. He was running for his life, too. Give him credit for being able to get that pass off. Their quarterbacks, that would have been nailed on the spot. And he came close. He came close. He showed his athleticism in that. So, but luckily it was a broken-up pass in the end zone, and the Raiders end up with the ball on downs. Now let's get it out in some more comfortable territory.
Kegel out to the right. Palmer split out to the left. I formation backfield. Pitt looks to be the deep back. Demetrius Thompson, the fullback. McClelland under center. Takes a snap. He's looking to pass. Throws it up. Looking for Kegel and a little too deep. Down the right numbers. It's going to bring up 2nd down and 10.
You know, we were talking about the wind being a factor on that. And that was a case where I think the ball did take a little bit a ride on top of the wind, and we got a little bit of yellow sitting on the ground over there.
Yep, flag on the play, sitting at the 15-yard line. Ineligible downfield against the Raiders.
And at this early in the season, not having a good hard scrimmage against somebody else, that's not an uncommon penalty, because offensive line on a play-action play, they can drive out for 2 yards, but then they have to retreat. And usually what happens, they forget to do the retreat business. And that's when they get them for the ineligible downfield.
So 1st and 15 for the Raiders at their own 10-yard line. McClelland sitting in the pistol with Pitt behind him and Thompson to his left. Takes a snap, drops back, pump fakes, looking to pass, steps up, and just barely avoids a safety. Taken down at the 1 yard line, a loss of 9 on the play will bring up a 2nd down and 24 for the Raiders.
And again, the heat on Craig coming from the outside on that play from both sides. The ends taken off and not doing a bump and run and allowing the defensive ends to come in and come down on Craig like that.
So now the Raiders backed up deep. McClelland will be standing in his end zone for the snap. Pitt the lone back in the back. Note, check that offset I formation backfield. Handoff goes to Pitt. Pitt is able to slip out of the end zone barely. Tackled by Jason Bott, a gain of maybe 1, we'll call it 1, and it's going to bring up 3rd and 23 for the Raiders, ball at their 2-yard line.
This is a situation where you don't think about getting the first down, you think about getting a little bit more room for your punter to get the ball out of there. And the saving grace is that Joel's going to have the wind at his back, so he ought to be able to boot that ball pretty good.
Kegel to the right, Palmer to the left, Worthington the tight end on the right side of the line. Pistol for McClelland, Thompson to his right, Pitt behind him. Looking to pass, has some time, lofts it up, looking for Palmer. Palmer, nice adjustment to the ball, but knocked away by Jordan Marshall out at the 35-yard line. And Joel DePraz's heels are going to be on the back of the end zone as he's going to have to come on to punt with 11:37 to play in the game. Raiders lead 17-6. That wind will be at his back.
Well, forget my previous comment, because they did go for try for the first down on that play with Palmer going out as deep as he did and McClelland staying inside the pocket. But again, the problem with Joel is he's got to be situational awareness, one step backward with the ball, and it's a safety.
New long snapper in Willis. Snap right to him, but we have a whistle, and it may back the Raiders up a yard. Might have been a false start, and that's fine. That was a horrible punt, really, by Joel DePraz.
He's going to be rushed, and he just doesn't have the time to set up and kick that ball.
Or did they call a timeout? No flag. Yeah, Lima called a timeout. It's not a flag. And that is one of those timeouts that you wish you would have kept in your pocket, because yeah. That was I don't think Joel would have a problem admitting that was far from his best punt of the season.
Maybe Joel called timeout and pointed at Lima saying, yeah, I did it. That was a gift. But again, Joel is going to be rushed to get that ball off his foot.
As our statistician Paul Junio points out, it's still a two-possession game if Joel would step out of the back of the end zone here, but he does not. And this one, he gets off a line drive punt, going to be fielded at the 41 by Kozad. Kozad goes towards the far sideline, the 30, gets the corner, 25-20, but he stepped out of bounds right at the 20-yard line. And out there on the tackle, Ambrose as well as Demetrius Thompson. But excellent starting field position for Lima as they'll have the ball in the red zone pretty much to start out.
Their past two series, they've been pretty good at mixing up the plays and keeping the defense on their toes. This is going to be interesting to see what happens. If they go with the double wideouts, they go with the trips on one side, the straight eye, who knows. They're going to mix it up, definitely. So the defense really has to come in and play on this series.
Raiders with an 11-point lead, 11:24 to play in the game. Lima with no timeouts remaining, but they have a first and 10 at the Raider 20. Two receivers to each side, Runyon in the shotgun with Bott to his left. Handoff goes to Bott, and Bott bowls ahead. No gain, it looks like, on the tackle. Nate Harris for the Raiders. May have also been trying to see who else gets up. Brandon Rogers. They're going to say he picked up maybe a foot on the play. It'll bring up a second down and 9 for Lima.
Same formation, but don't bet they're going to run that same play.
Bott to the right of Runyon. Looking to his left. Throws it up. Looking end zone and falls incomplete. A little wide. Looked to be intended for David King out there. It's going to bring up a 3rd and 9 for Lima. 10:43 to play in regulation. Raiders lead 17-6.
Yeah, that pass was headed toward the maple trees. It would have been very hard to catch it. The receiver was off balance, and by the time he was near the ball, he was already out of bounds.
Check that intended for Jay Johnson. Johnson was the receiver out to the left. Once again, same formation, 3rd and 9, ball at the Raider 19-yard line. Runyon looking to his right, now checks back to his left, throws it up.
Same play.
And incomplete, same play, threw it inbounds this time. Laverl Johnson all over Jay Johnson, and it brings up a 4th and 9 for Lima. And I tell you, Lima, if they would have brought a kicker to this game,
it would have been a different story on that scoreboard.
Yeah, very different story.
In fact, they'd probably be up by three.
Well, they'd be going for the lead right here, I'd imagine. But now a 4th and 9 ball at the Raider 19-yard line. 10:30 to play in the game. Raiders lead by 11. Two receivers left, two to the right. Runyon in the shotgun, Bott to his right. Crowd really getting into it. Takes a snap, looking to his right, throws it, and picked off. Picked off by Eric Feast. Feast to the 30, the 40, and runs out of bounds. And the third interception of the game for Runyon. And the Raiders will have the ball up at the 40-yard line. Eric Feast with a pick.
I am going to go to the point and say right now, if there is a play of the game that the Raiders end up winning, it's going to be this one. Had that ball gone into the end zone, it would have been a very difficult fourth quarter. They set up in that same formation. They tried three plays to the left. They weren't going to go that way. Feast knew they had to come to the right in that formation, and he read that play just perfectly.
Dave, after this play, we'll bring it down to you. Dave Tukesbrey on the sideline for us tonight. D'Elia to the left, Kegel to the right. I formation offset to the left, Marcus Baskin and J.R. Taylor. Tight end on the left side of the formation. Handoff goes to Taylor. Taylor picks the lane. Taylor midfield. Taylor breaks
right
free.
Up, there he goes.
Taylor the 30. The 20, J.R. Taylor all the way into the end zone. Touchdown Raiders. 57 yards. J.R. Taylor finally breaks free on one, and the Raiders open up a 23-6 lead with 10:08 to play in the fourth quarter.
As I mentioned before, Demonte Pitt, you can't take anything away from him. He did an outstanding job getting the little stuff. J.R. Taylor is the guy you go for the big stuff. Lima went to sleep. They were expecting a Demonte Pitt play. They forgot J.R. Taylor got the ball, and boom, down he went into the promised land.
Joel DePron for the extra point to try and give the Raiders a 24-6 lead. Willis the long snapper, Feast the holder. The snap, the hold is down, the kick is up, and the Raiders lead 24-6. And instead of sending it to break, why don't we send it down to Dave on the sidelines?
Yeah, Don, again, I was talking to defensive backs head coach Pedro Trevino before the game, and he said he was kind of reticent to put Eric Feast out there on the field because he had been missing so much practice this whole week. And now you talk about a game changer. He gets the pick right there, some defense leading the offense for J.R. Taylor for the big touchdown run. 24-6 Raiders with 10:08 left to go.
Thank you, Dave. Great job down on the sideline for Dave in his first game with us here on WRJN and the Racine Raiders broadcast.
You got to give Feast credit for going out of bounds when he did. He knew he had good yardage. He didn't try to stretch it out and possibly cut in, lose the ball or something like that. Good heads-up playing by Eric.
And the Raiders lead 24-6. Turnovers, they've turned them into points here in the second half to the tune of 17 points off of 3 Lima turnovers. Joel DePron to kick off. Has the wind at his back. Puts a lot of leg into that one. It's going to be fielded by King in the end zone, and he takes a knee. Lima will start with the ball 1st and 10 at their own 20-yard line, and now the clock is Lima's enemy as they have no timeouts remaining, and they trail by 18, so that's 3 scores no matter what way you run it through the system there, Tom.
Run it through the wash. It comes out, like you said, 3 scores. And again, you go back to that series where they had Demonte in. That was a clock-killing series. It ate up a lot of clock. Like you said, the clock is Lima's worst enemies right now. And it goes back to that timeout on the punt that Joel had a kick from almost at the end line. It's one of those they're going to wish he had back.
Two receivers left, two receivers right. Bott to the right of Runyon. Runyon in the shotgun. Looking under immediate pressure, throws it out to his left. Catch is made by David Johnson. He slips out of a tackle at the 27, brought from down from behind up at the 35. Jose Santiago on the tackle, a gain of 15 on first down. Gives Lima another first and 10, under 10 minutes to play now at their 35-yard line.
Jose Santiago has made a couple of good heads-up tackles in this game. The first quarter did the ankle tackle when he was on the ground, and this one catching up with the receiver and preventing a much more bigger yardage gain.
Four receiver set again. Handoff goes to Bott this time, and Bott is swallowed up by that defensive line. Initial contact by Marcus Fletcher. Going to be a loss of two. Brings up second down and 12 for the Lima Warriors.
Yeah, if you had to make, you had to give somebody credit for a tackle on that one, you got to split it up by seven. There are seven guys on top of that pile and kill that play right there.
Empty backfield, three receivers to the bottom, two receivers to the top. Laverl Johnson asking for help as he's the only DB over there, and seeing that, Runyon with a quick pass out to the right side, but Johnson does a great job of getting on to the pass receiver. That was Bott, and Bott picks up three. It'll bring up third down and nine. Ball at the 36-yard line of Lima.
And what's hurting Lima right now, they're not able to get that ball out of bounds, too. Good coverage by the defensive end over there.
Under 8.5 to play. Raiders lead by 18. Empty backfield again for Runyon. Runyon under immediate pressure, rolling out to his right, looking to pass, throws it in and out of the hands of David Johnson. Would have had enough yardage for the first down, but I think he heard footsteps or was trying to run before he caught it. It's going to bring up a fourth and nine, and Lima looks like they're going to punt.
That was the same play where they had three receivers to the one side. Johnson got wide open. Part of that incompletion was that he slipped just as he tried jumping for the ball and just couldn't get a hand on it.
Macklin on to punt. He'll be inside his 25-yard line. Snap is high, he brings it down, gets the kick off, a line drive kick, and a hit at the 32. Be picked up by the Raiders at the 27 and run up to the 38, and two flags on the play on the return for Racine Markell Bradley.
Billy Kozad was the gunner on that punt, and he probably got a couple of hands on him, and probably going to be a holding call.
Legal block in the back, it sounds like, against the Raiders. So move it back. Spot foul from the 36. Push it back, or from the 37. Push it back to the 27-yard line. First and 10 Racine at their own 27-yard line. 8:02 remaining in the game. Raiders lead 24-6.
Clock tilling series coming up by the Raiders for this one.
1,249 fans treated to a great game here tonight. McClelland in the pistol. Marcus Baskin to his left. Back deep in the backfield behind him. Pitch goes to Ivory Lashley, and Lashley gets up to the 27-yard line, maybe gets back to the original line of scrimmage, a second down and 10.
And again, that pitch out, it was kind of wide open, telegraphed when McClellan let go of that ball. But again, it's nothing that the Raiders are going to worry about, because their job right here is to kill the clock, to eat up time, and get this one in the books.
Ivory Lashley getting some work. Kegel to the left, D'Elia to the right. Offset I formation backfield. Baskin set off to the right. Hand off to Lashley. Lashley taking a defender with him, knocking other defenders to the ground, punishing people as he gets across the 30 to the 32-yard line. A gain of five on the play, but a flag from the far side judge.
Lashley doing a good job at keeping his feet going.
Illegal formation against the Raiders. So it'll bring up a second down and 15 now. Ball at the 22-yard line.
Usually what happens in those illegal formations, a slot back isn't back far enough. He's in what they call no man's land. Either he's not established on the line or not established clearly in the backfield, and that's what gets him in trouble.
Now the Raiders, as we said, coming into this one, 24-0 against teams from Ohio. Average margin of victory, Tom, 27-6. Look at the scoreboard, 24-6 right now.
They need a field goal.
Floyd Underwood, the deep back. D'Elia to the right, Kegel to the left. Second and 15 for the Raiders at their own 22. Looking to pass McClellan, he's going to be taken down, sacked. Back at the 17-yard line, and on the sack for Lima, number 55, Benny Woods.
A sack, but again, the clock is going. Yeah, the Raiders are going to end up kicking the ball on this series, but there's no way that Lima can stop the ball except by going out of bounds.
Third,
and then the clock starts when the ball's set to play.
Third and 20 for the Raiders. Ball back at the 17-yard line. 6.5 minutes remaining in this one. Raiders with it well in control, 24-6. As Tom said, no timeouts remaining for Lima. I believe they had to waste two this half on punts. McClellan in the pistol, Baskin to his left. Floyd Underwood, the deep back. The handoff goes to Underwood. Underwood still on his feet as he gets across the 20, all the way up to the 25-yard line, a gain of 8. Fourth down and 12 for the Raiders. And Joel DePras will come on to punt.
You know, you gotta say something about Coach Profeto. He's getting a good look at some of his running backs. You know, you saw the two standards, Underwood and Taylor. Last series of plays, you saw, Lashley and Pitt, and they've done an excellent job in that position.
DePras back at his 10, gets it off, nearly blocked, a nice booming punt. Kozad brings it in the 34-yard line, slips a tackle, and then I think two Raiders collided as Kozad ducked underneath it. Willis and Torrey Ruffin. Kozad up to the 44-yard line. It'll be first and 10 for Lima there.
Kozak had no choice but to duck, because if he would have stood up, he would have been sandwiched on that play. Torrey Ruffin was coming in. He had his arms wide open. He could have taken both of these guys.
Should point out, Lima did bring around 35 players here tonight. It's not that they are that short of a squad here tonight.
Yeah, exactly, and that's what I pointed out earlier. You know, they don't have their full bench, but it's not a real short bench like we've seen in the past with teams that had to travel that distance.
Of course, I know they're missing a couple of their normal starting receivers, their starting running back, starting defensive end. Several key players couldn't make the trip. Three receivers right, one receiver to the left. Bott originally went to be out to the right. Comes back into the backfield to block for Runyon. Runyon is hit as he throws it, and nearly a one-handed interception by Phil Palos at the 45-yard line. Couldn't quite haul it in, and it'll bring up second down and 10 with 5:22 to play in the regulation.
Phil Palos and Torrey Ruffin were both going for that ball. Torrey was in that catcher's stance on his knees, and Palos was over the top, and they both wanted that ball at the same time.
Damian McGee applying pressure may have hit the arm or at least hit Runyon right as he threw that one. Empty backfield, three receivers left, two to the right, Runyon all alone. Second and 10, ball at the 45 of Lima, 5:22 remaining. Runyon looking under pressure, Michael Ambrose brings him down. A sack for Ambrose. Inside the 40, back to the 39-yard line, a loss of 6. Third and 16 for the Warriors.
The Raiders definitely adjusted on that with the three receivers on the far side, because they were all covered, and Runyon had nothing to throw out there, and that led to the sack.
Sal Sanchez checks into the game for Damian McGee. Third and 16, ball on the 39-yard line of Lima. Under 5 minutes remaining in the game. Raiders with an 18-point lead. Empty backfield, three receivers left, two to the right. Runyon looking under pressure from Sanchez, throws it out, deflected and intercepted. Ross Teller, Teller with the sideline, Teller the 20, the 10, he cuts in, touchdown Raiders, a pick six for Ross Teller, and the Raiders lead 30-6 with 4:26 to play, about a 55-yard return for Teller. And Feast deflected the ball, and Teller was there to pick it out of the air.
And Teller just some unbelievable moves down by the goal line. He should have been tackled twice. He put on a hula skirt and did some hip movements and got him in the end zone.
Last week he was in the Dominican Republic on a church mission, I believe, and maybe he learned some extra moves down there.
Maybe he got the hula skirt down there. Oh, they don't hula in Dominican Republic.
Joel Dupron for the extra point. Kick is up and it is good, and the Raiders lead 31-6 as there's a little bit of extracurricular, but they break it up quickly. 31-6, Racine leads Lima with 4:26 remaining in the game. We'll take a break. You're listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN, Racine,
Canada. Joel Dupra approaches the ball. Raiders lead 31-6, 4:26 remaining. Fielded at the goal line, brought out from there by Lima. 20 up to the 23-yard line. Lima will start first and 10 at their own 23. No timeouts remaining and trailing by 25. On the return, David Johnson.
This is a good opportunity to get some guys a look-see. Having a comfortable lead right now at 4:17, you're probably going to see some guys that just joined up with the club this season and get a couple reps in here and get their pants dirty, and we can sit up here and evaluate them.
Runyon controlling traffic. Lima receivers a little late getting out there. Yancey Donald will be in the backfield. Actually, is that still Runyon out there? I think they have a quarterback change. Looks like it might be Justin Henderson. Henderson in at quarterback. Hands it off to Yancey Donald, and Donald brings it to the 25-yard line. A gain of a couple, second down and 8 for Lima.
Good job by the defensive line stringing out the line, reading the play as a run, and then just stringing out the line to the side of the play and eliminating it to 2 yards.
Actually, they say no gain, second down and 10.
Good job in limiting it to nothing.
Under 4 minutes left to play in the game. Raiders with a 25-point lead. Three receivers right, one receiver left is Henderson in there at quarterback. Henderson pump fakes, pulls it back, now throws it up, and a lot of contact. Pass interference is going to be called or holding against Brandon Fenderson. Two flags on the play.
Yeah, He kind of came up behind him. Questionable, was he playing the ball or on the back of the receiver? And it's going to be on the back of the receiver, tripping the receiver.
Bobby Huddis, the intended receiver for Lima. And it is pass interference. Ball will be at the 39-yard line. Automatic first down, first and 10 for Lima at their own 39. 3:32 remaining in regulation. Three receivers right, one receiver left. Henderson in the shotgun. Donald to his left, stays in to block. Looking to his right and throws it complete to Marvin Germany. Nice footwork by Germany in Raider territory at the 46-yard line. A gain of 15 and a first down for Lima.
Got to give Germany credit for, and we're talking about the individual, not Team Germany, credit for keeping his feet in bounds and getting the yardage out of that.
Receiver to the left, three receivers to the right. Henderson barking out the signals, barking out the play to his receivers on the right side. Bott to his right as Donald checks out. Now Henderson moves Bott to his left side. Looking to pass, Quick pass in and out of the hands and picked off by Steve Kleist. Off of Germany, Kleist into Lima territory and brought down at the 34-yard line. The Raiders will have the ball first and 10 at the Lima 34, and they lead by 25.
Steve Kleist came to play tonight because he just could have sat back and, you know, we got a comfortable lead, let the ball hit the ground. He came up like this was a championship game and took that ball and just made something out of it. Give him an E for effort,
Fifth interception by the defense tonight. And in the game, Chris Walsh at quarterback. Antonio Fontanez to the left. Handoff goes to Ivory Lashley, left side, and Lashley upended at the 25-yard line. A gain of 8 will bring up second down and 2 as we hit the 3-minute mark of the fourth quarter.
Good job by Ivory hanging on to that ball. He got up, and like you said, he got upended, and usually guys drop the ball and when they come down on the shoulders. He tucked it and hung on to it.
And with that run, the Raiders now over 200 yards of total offense in the game. Offset eye formation backfield behind Walsh. Walsh with the pitch to Lashley. Nice move. Lashley, the 20. Lashley inside the 15. Brought down at the 12. A gain of 13. And a Raiders first down.
Chris Walsh is a quarterback that's been with the team on and off. And he had that opportunity to go out and do something, and he executed that pitch out just perfectly. And Lashley got it, found the hole, and made something out of it.
After this play, we'll send it down to Dave on the sideline, splitting out wide to the right. Lonnie Satterfield to the left. Antonio Fontanez. Now Walsh walking towards the sideline as we've reached the two-minute warning, and why don't we send it down to Dave on the sidelines?
All right, Don, really more just of an observation, to be honest with you. I mean, 5 picks so far tonight for the defense, 3 of the 5 coming via the tip drill. I mean, every time the ball goes into the air, these guys, they don't just tip it, they go for it. And I got to be really impressed by this defense right now. Not a bad effort for the first game of the season.
Yeah, very great effort by this defense for the first game. Several turnovers, had a couple of fumble recoveries as well in this one. One fumble recovery to go with those 5 interceptions. 5 interceptions, 152 return yards on the game for the Raiders defense to go with their 1 fumble recovery. 6 turnovers in all for the defense. The Raiders have turned the ball over just once, a +5 margin, and that's what you're looking for in these games, Tom.
Yeah, this one's in the big in the win column, and I think I can put my shoes back on now.
Thankfully. Satterfield out to the right, Fontanez to the left, offset eye formation backfield behind Walsh, Lashley the deep back. First and 10 for the Raiders at the 13-yard line. The handoff goes to Demetrius Thompson, the fullback. He punishes his way ahead and gets to the 10. A gain of 3 will bring up second down and 7 for Racine.
Good job by Demetrius in grabbing that ball. Walsh was a little bit animated on the fake pitch out, and Demetrius had to reach up to get that ball as it was coming down by Chris, and he got that ball instead of getting it right in the breadbasket, reached up and brought it in and hung onto it.
And Dave, maybe if you could get near head coach Gino Perfetto, he's standing at about the 50-yard line for a quick post-game talk as the handoff goes to Lashley, and Lashley is the play strung out.
He's stringed out.
To the 7-yard line, maybe 6, a gain of 3 or 4 on the play will bring up a 3rd down and 4 for the Raiders.
That play just had you lost for words, didn't it?
I was trying to, you know, I forgot to tell Dave about the post-game interview, so I wanted to make sure that I got that in there. Some instructions we didn't give him before the game.
You talk to him, I'll do the play-by-play.
If you could get head coach Gino Perfetto, Dave, before for right after the game. He's standing at the 50-yard line here. Likely the final play of the game, 3rd and 3, ball on the 6-yard line. Lashley the deep back, Walsh under center.
False start.
And we have a false start. Umpire throws the flag.
that could have been a little bit of a jerk by Chris. He came out from under center without the ball and went back in, so that's probably his fault.
Bring up a third down and 8 for the Raiders. 31 ticks left on the clock. The Raiders are going to improve to 2-0 on this season. Win streak improves to 16 games. The franchise improves to 25-0 against teams from Ohio, and that margin of victory of 27-6 will increase slightly as we're at 31-6 in this one. Walsh with the play action, looking to pass, throws it for Thompson and throws it too high. It'll bring up a fourth down and 8 for the Raiders.
Chris has another opportunity to throw a pass in into the end zone. Unless he just takes a knee and calls it quits.
4 seconds left on the clock. As the fans start to clear out, 1,249 of them here tonight on a gorgeous night in Racine, Wisconsin, as the Raiders will improve to 2-0 on the season, and now we have a false start. Dusty Swenson apparently had some leftover energy and just got out of the blocks a little early.
Settle down, Dusty.
The Raiders will open their Mid-States Football League season next week here at home against the Madison Mustangs, a game that people have been waiting for probably a decade. Fourth and 13, ball at the 17-yard line. Walsh backs out, audibles at the line. 4 seconds left to play. Takes a snap, looking to pass, and now he's going to tuck it away and run. And Walsh is going to be brought down after a 7-yard gain at the 10-yard line as time expires. And the Raiders win 31-6 here tonight. And I don't know if Dave has head coach Gino Perfetto on the sideline, so we'll send it down to him.
Yes, I do, Don. Coach, 31-6, a very convincing victory tonight. First game of the season, not too shabby, huh?
Thrilled with the way our defense played tonight. They really carried us. Our offense sputtered at times, but we came up with some really big plays down the stretch, but our defense just played outstanding.
You gave me a perfect segue. 6 turnovers for the defense tonight. They were fantastic. 5 of them coming via the interception. How about a pick 6-2? Nice way to start off the season.
Our red zone defense was just tremendous. I think we had to stop him at least 3-4 times in the red zone. That's cute. That's just huge.
All right, Coach, best of luck next week against Madison.
All right, thanks very much. Appreciate it.
All right, Don, back up to you guys.
Thank you. And maybe if you can catch Ross Teller after they huddle at midfield, Dave, number 33, we can talk to him about his pick 6. But give him some time. We'll come back from the break and go over stats and everything. So 35-6, the final here, or 31-6, the final here tonight. The Raiders over the Lima Warriors. Why don't we take a break and we'll come back with the final stats of the game and we'll preview next week's game against the Madison Mustangs. You're listening to Racine Raiders Football on News Talk 1400, WRJN.
WRJN.
Welcome back to historic Horlick Field. The Raiders improved to 2-0 on the 2013 season with a 31-6 victory over the Lima Warriors. It's the 16th straight game the Raiders have won. They improve as a franchise to 25-0 against teams from Ohio and improve on the average a little bit, which they came in averaging winning 27-6 and outscoring opponents from Ohio 639-148. So they improve on that ever so slightly as well, Tom. A pretty dominating win for the Raiders. Although at the half, it was a 7-0 game. It wasn't until that second half started when they got 10 quick points off of Lima turnovers that they turned this game into not necessarily a cakewalk, but a little bit more of a walk in the park.
Well, Gino, you know, saw the same thing that we were seeing up here, that the offense was struggling in the first half. There's no doubt about it. They have some work to do, especially in that offensive line. The problem there, again, was going back to the splits on the offensive line, letting those defensive guys come in through those gaps. They've got to work on that, get guys to practice, and take care of that. The second half, they were a completely different ball team. They made the corrections. Again, the thing that hurt them were mistakes. And you look at the penalties, 100 yards, 12 penalties for 100 yards. That was the thing that was the curse on the Raiders last year. They got to get those penalty point yards down. Defense, they played a pretty good game. There was a couple of times they got burnt. You know, like I said, Kozad was just an outstanding athlete getting to places where, you know, where did he come from? But they adjusted. They adjusted to the three wideouts on the strong side, and the defense played a heck of a game tonight.
Looking at team stats, Lima had more first downs, 16 to 11. The Raiders with 30 rushes, 154 yards, thanks to that long TD run by J.R. Taylor. Take a look at the scoring here. The Raiders got on the board first with 11:03 to play in the first quarter. Sam D'Elia, a four-yard pass from Craig McClellan. The DePra kick was good. A seven-play, 65-yard drive took up 3 minutes and 57 seconds. Raiders led 7-0. That would be the lead going into the half. Then, hey Paul, if you can lower that for me for the, sorry, Paul Junio, he's trying to get me the
individual stats. He's still playing solitaire.
And we're trying to get to the scoring highlights.
While he's doing that, I go back to the play of the game. It occurred in the third quarter. That pick off, was it Ross Teller that picked it off?
Yep.
That was the fourth quarter. That was the play of the game.
So in the second quarter, 12:02, Joel DePra off a turnover, a 23-yard field goal. It was a 2-minute drive that went for minus 1 yard. Raiders led 10-0. Then just less than 30 seconds later, after an interception, Travis Worthington, a 25-yard TD pass from Craig McClellan. The DePra kick was good. It was a one-play, 25-yard drive. Raiders led 17-0. Lima got their only score with 4:46 to play in the third quarter. Jeremy Bott, a 6-yard TD run. Kane Runyon's pass for 2-point conversion failed. It was a 12-play, 70-yard drive, took up 6 minutes and 52 seconds, cut the Raiders' lead to 11. But then with 10:08 to play in the game, J.R. Taylor busted out a 57-yard TD run. DePra added the extra point. That was the only play of the drive. Raiders led 24-6. And then the exclamation point from Ross Teller, a 55-yard interception return, took it to the house, a pick six. The DePra kick was good. The Raiders led by the final score of 31-6 to improve to 2-0 on the season. Meanwhile, Lima falls to 4-4 overall, and they, of course, remain at 4-2 in their Heartland Football League. A rough season thus far for Lima, as they've dropped 3 games to teams that lay claim to a 2012 national championship. Lima, as I said, led first down 16-11. Raiders 30 rushes, 154 yards, thanks to that 57-yard run by J.R. Taylor. Lima 22-48. Passing yards, net passing yards, Raiders only with 71 passing yards to 181 for Lima. Overall, they are 20-46 with 5 interceptions. Craig McClellan, 6-14, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. 74 total offensive plays for Lima to just 49 for the Raiders, but the yardage very similar, 229 for Lima, 225 for the Raiders. The interceptions, 5 for Racine, 1 for Lima. Time of possession, almost even, 30-38 for Lima, 29-22 for Racine. The penalties that Tom already pointed out, 1-5 for Lima, 12-100 for the Raiders. So once again, early season, those penalties, the Raiders need to work that out. Jeremy Bott, 14 carries, 29 yards, led Lima. Kane Runyon, 4-17. Zach Jackson, 2-2. Yancey Donald, 2-no yards. J.R. Taylor, 11 carries, 76 yards. Demonche Pitt, 6-29. Ivory Lashley, 4-23. Floyd Underwood, 4-14. Demetrius Thompson, 1-3. McClellan, 2-3. Runyon, 19-44 in the game, 202 yards, no touchdowns, 4 interceptions. Justin Henderson in relief, 1-2, 1 interception, 15 yards. And the Raiders, McClellan, 6-13, 114 yards. Two touchdowns, one interception. Chris Walsh was 0-for-1 in the game. Billy Kozad, 7 catches, 64 yards. David Johnson came on in the second half for Lima, 6 for 91 yards. Jeremy Bott, 3 for 22. Marvin Germany, 2 for 25. The Raiders, Palmer, 2 for 57. Dom Kegel, 2 for 28. Worthington, the TD catch, as well as D'Elia, his 4-yard TD catch. And the interceptions came from 5 different players for the Raiders. Teller, Feast, Kleist, Hurd, and Harris all had interceptions, and the Raiders improved to 2-0 in front of 1,249 fans here at historic Horlick Athletic Field tonight. And that sets up the MSFL season opener next week. The Raiders begin defense of their MSFL championship against the Madison Mustangs. The Mustangs moved from the Ironman Football League to the MSFL this offseason. They lost the IFL championship game to the Wauwatosa Spartans last season, but won 5 IFL championships in their time in that league. They compiled a winning streak of over 50 games before losing in that IFL championship last season. And doing some stat digging, the Raiders are 5-11 all time against the Madison Mustangs, including 3-5 here at Horlick Field. The team's last played, Tom, can you guess the year?
I would say it was back in the 70s.
The year of my birth, 1974, at historic Horlick Athletic
Field. The old
Field.
Central States Football League. And I was about to mention that Racine has a historic presence in Racine, and so does the Madison Mustangs. Yeah, it's not the same Mustang team that played in the CSFL, but it carries that same name. And along with that name, the rivalry. So this is going to be a real good game. This may be the rebirth of a rivalry that was a big one 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah, the team's last playing in 1974, 2 times that year. The last time the Raiders won 23-10, that was under head coach Warren Greco.
Mm-hmm.
But in the first game of that season, they met at historic Horlick Field in a non-league game. It was kind of one of those games that they wanted for a non-league game, even though the two teams were in the same league, and the Mustangs doubled up the Raiders 34-17. We talk about that new incarnation of the Mustangs. They came about in 1989. They were the Partyville Seminoles. They moved to Madison in 2001 and then finally changed their name and taking on the records in the history of the Madison Mustangs franchise back in 2007. So it'll be an exciting game, a game that people have been waiting a decade for to happen. It will take place here at historic Horlick Athletic Field, another epic matchup taking place here at historic Horlick Field. So make sure you come on out next Saturday. It's sure to be a great crowd next Saturday for this matchup, as I think a lot of people want to see this one. It's been talked about for years, Tom.
And I think you're going to see a bunch of old-timers that, well, I'm kind of stating my age, I guess, that were at that Madison Racine game that are going to come out to see that. Because when you're a team, a rebirth team like that, and you pick up the name of a very historic team, which the Mustangs were in Madison, You got a lot to carry with that, and you can't let your fans down. Like the Raiders, coming back and with the Raider name, it's a lot of responsibility to carry.
Want to remind you, Monday night, head out to the Texas Roadhouse. All the proceeds from your meal will go to the Racine Raiders organization between 4 p.m. and close. So head out to Texas Roadhouse, eat there on Monday. We want to thank all of our sponsors on the broadcast. And the Raiders, stay tuned to the Raiders on the website, RacineRaiders.com, on Twitter at Racine Raiders, and Facebook, search for Racine Raiders Football Club. Make sure you stay tuned. There's a new fan e-newsletter that you can sign up for on the website to stay on top of all the action, of course, in the Racine Journal Times and right here on News Talk 1400 WRJN, the coaches show on Saturday mornings at 9:05. I think I'll be filling in for Tom this upcoming week, but also throughout the week as the WRJN provides the best local coverage on the radio of the Racine Raiders, including our broadcast. I want to thank Brandon back at the studios, Dave Tukesbrey, who did a great job in his first game on the sidelines for us. I want to thank him for his excellent work.
Not bad, rookie.
Yeah, not bad at all. Tom Christensen to my right. I'm Don Wadewitz. We thank you for tuning in to Racine Raiders football. 31-6, the Raiders improved to 2-0 on the season, a 16-game win streak. Next week, the Madison Mustangs, 6:45 p.m. pregame show right here on News Talk 1400 WRJN. You've been listening to Racine Raiders football on News Talk 1400 WRJN.